मैं आपसे
कुछ
एंड योर एफर्ट्स मस्ट बी कॉम्प्लीमेंटेड द वे यू हैव कंट्रीब्यूटेड इन हेल्पिंग दिस न्यू नॉर्मल इमर्स
थैंक यू
ट्रेमेंडस
वी आर ऑल ट्राइंग वी आर ऑल इन सेम बोट शर्मा सर
यू आर द लीडर्स वी आर द फॉलोअर्स
नमस्कार सब सभी को
नमस्कार पुनिया साहब
आप मुझे जानते हैं नमस्कार
नमस्ते नमस्ते
नमस्कार साहब नमस्कार नमस्कार
नमस्कार सर
नमस्ते नमस्ते
नमस्ते सर कैसे हो सब कैसे हो
एक इजाजत चाहता था पुनिया साहब कि अपनी क्लोज ग्रुप मीटिंग ही है ना क्लोज ग्रुप ही है या पब्लिक है ये
हाँ हाँ
इज इट
साहब बताओ
हाँ ये क्लोज ग्रुप मीटिंग है या पब्लिक में भी है ये
इस पब्लिक पीपल आर कनेक्टेड
ओके
थ्रू थ्रू दिस यूट्यूब
ओके सर ओके मुझे 3:15 बजे थोड़ा सा टाइम ऑफ लेना पड़ेगा 3:15 से 4:15 तक अगर मेरे को एग्जिट उतने टाइम के लिए मिल जाए तो मेरे स्टूडेंट्स का मेजर फंक्शन लॉन्च हो रहा है और मैं अवॉइड नहीं कर पाया टाइम क्लैश कर गया एक्सपर्ट्स की वजह से
तो हम आपको 3:15 से पहले एक बार लेंगे फिर आपको 4:15 बजे वापस जो है
थैंक यू
एक्सपर्ट्स कौन कौन है
सुनील गुप्ता सर है बंसल सर है रंजन बोस सर इज अबाउट टू जॉइन
सुनील
सर
to all the panelists on board for today's session, sir. At AICT, we take great pleasure in inviting each one of you. This is a series of webinars, or we would rather use the word brainstorming sessions, which are happening on the implementation purposes of the New Education Policy 2020. We have already had 5 earlier sessions, and this is the 6th session. But today's subject discussion, wherein we will be having an in-house discussion primarily with the panelists and AICT officials. The topic or subject today happens to be access, equity, quality, affordability, and accountability. And as far as the forum of the topic goes, sir, the topic would be introduced. Our Honorable Vice Chairman, sir, will commence with the proceedings, wherein at first we will be requesting all the panelists to please speak about 7 to 10 minutes on the given topic. As far as their understanding for implementation is concerned, subsequently, as already highlighted by the Honorable Vice Chairman, this is being showcased live on YouTube and all participants column also in the same forum, wherein participants have been encouraged to keep continuously put in the chat box their recommendation, opinion, views, and any queries or questions which keep coming. So towards the concluding time, we will be taking up these queries, and they will also be put forward to the panelists for their opinion and their remark. Pleasure in welcoming our panelists for the day, Professor Sandeep Sancheti, sir, Vice Chancellor, SRM University. Professor Rakesh Sharma, sir, Vice Chancellor, Graphic Era University.
Thank you.
Professor Sunil Gupta, sir, Vice Chancellor, RGPV Bhopal.
सर नमस्कार, पुनिया सर नमस्कार।
नमस्ते नमस्ते नमस्ते।
प्रोफेसर प्रोफेसर वीएम बंसल, नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट, चेयरमैन सर।
न्यू दिल्ली
ऑनरेबल वाइस चेयरमैन प्रोफेसर एम पी पूनिया सर टू प्लीज कमेंस विद द डेज प्रोसीडिंग्स।
थैंक यू कर्नल बंसल, गुड आफ्टरनून। डॉक्टर राकेश शर्मा जी, ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर ग्राफिक्स एरा यूनिवर्सिटी देहरादून। प्रोफेसर संजीव संदीप संचेती जी, ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर एसआरएम यूनिवर्सिटी। प्रोफेसर सुनील गुप्ता, ऑनरेबल वाइस चांसलर आरजीटीवी भोपाल। वीके बंसल जी, इट इज न्यू दिल्ली इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ मैनेजमेंट, वन ऑफ दी प्रोमिनेंट इंस्टीट्यूट इन द कंट्री। प्रोफेसर रंजन बोस फ्रॉम आईआईटी दिल्ली। First of all, I'll welcome all the panelists and the participants who are connected here in this very, very important event. New education policy, everyone is knowing that after 34 years, we are having a vision document and everyone is appreciating that the vision which has been put forward in front of the country, it will change the shape of the education in whole country of ours as well as in whole world. We'll be able to create some vibrations, some positive vibrations we'll be able to create. Even it is being said that 10 more countries, they are in the queue, they are willing to adopt our new education policy. So certainly it's a proud moment for everyone. It is being said continuously that whatever mechanism of education we had during last 70 years, it is just one sort of bindings on the institutes, bindings on the teachers, binding on the students. No autonomy was available. It is being said that whatever philosophy of Macaulay had, the same philosophy we were having, just reading, writing and reproducing that sort of mechanism we had. But now in new education policy, the hopes which are that enormous autonomy will be available for the academic institutes. Same time teachers will be empowered and students will be having many opportunities in terms of getting their education in multidisciplinary areas. Even they'll be having opportunity to come out from the education as and when they want, and whenever they want, they can enter into this one. Many subjects, many sort of activities they'll be having during this one. Their critical thinking, problem solving abilities, cognitive skills will be enhanced through this one. So enormous level of freedom will be available. This whole new education policy, we have divided from the higher education point of view, we are divided in 8 categories, in fact, and it is fifth category we are discussing today. We have started with online and distance education, and particularly how education can reach to the extreme corner of the country through this online mechanism, through distance education mechanism. And finally, anyone who is willing to enter into this higher education, they should be able to get the opportunity to avail the facilities and avail the getting competencies in education. So that sort of chapter we had, and one session we have kept for this one. And even today's topic, which it has been decided, it is access, equity, quality, affordability and accountability. So access is directly related to this online and distance education mechanism also. Access, when we are saying nearby, wherever any children is there, nearby in neighborhood, what facility is available so that he can avail the facility of educational institutes and he can be groomed according to his or her willingness. So nearby, in the near vicinity, what exactly it is available, that will be saying access. And finally, the outcome, it has to be that individual or the whole community or whole society should be benefited with that sort of education. There has to be some standards, there has to be some norms, quality teachers it has to be, quality learning tools it has to be, and then safe and secured environment, greater ambience of learning it has to be in those academic institutes. So which can increase the access and even affordability also. The cost of education is also very, very important. So how the cost of the education can be brought down? So certainly this online and distance mechanism may be one form of mechanism which can increase the enrollment ratio as well as which can reduce the cost of education also. In our education policy, the first and foremost important point which is written, that is about our gross enrollment ratio. And it is being said that our gross enrollment ratio is only 26.3%. And meaning of that one, definition of gross enrollment ratio, when we are saying in the age group of 18 to 23 years, any children who is available in the age group of 18 to 23 years, and how many of them are getting opportunity to enter into higher education. However, this is a debatable issue, that the definition of this one which is given, that may also be some contradiction into this one. As compared to ours, if you are saying in US, the same gross enrollment ratio with same definition between age group of 18 to 23, how many are able to enter into colleges? Total numbers, it is being said, in US it is 83%, in Germany it is 70%, France it is 65.6%, UK 61%, Brazil 51%, our neighbor China 49.1%. Certain contradictions are also there, because in our school education, and particularly in 11th, 12th, our enrollment is not 100%. So in the age group of 18 to 23, many of the children are available who doesn't have qualification of class 12th. If they are not having the qualification of class 12th, how we can calculate, how we can consider them in higher education while we are calculating the gross enrollment ratio? So new definition of this one, which has been given, even at international level in our country also, it has been said EER, eligible enrollment ratio. It is not basically GER, it is EER, eligible enrollment ratio. In that case, these students in the age group of 18 to 23 who have passed class 12, what is that number? And out of that one, how many are entering into this higher education? If we are doing that calculation, then our EER is around 64%. US it is 93%, EER of US is 93%, and this China it is around 672%, France it is 76%, but ours may be at fourth or fifth number like this one if you are calculating the EER. Then the next topic which you have kept, that is related to research and innovation funding like this one. When funding will be increased, our new education policy is saying that our total GDP is 6%, it has to be contributed towards this education. Even in first education policy, which was there, first, second, even in third, everywhere the 6% it is mentioned. But when we are saying better research facilities, better innovative capability building of these students, and if proper funding is there, then certainly the quality of education will improve. So the issue is quality also. And even definition of quality, when we are saying, probably many of them may not be able to understand what exactly quality is. When we are defining quality, as per my understanding, suppose any particular subject I am teaching, first of all, I should be, as a teacher, I should be able to create interest of the students inside the class related to my subject. Inclination of the students towards my subject, it has to be. When I'll be imparting education or skills to the children in a semester or in a year, when they'll be going out, the learning outcomes which they are having, with those learning outcomes, you know, the needs of an individual, needs of the community, and needs of the society, if it is being fulfilled according to the dreams of the whole society and community, if they are able to fulfill the dreams, it means it's a quality education. Maybe related to their cognitive skills improvement, maybe related to their physical, mental, social connect, whatever it may be. If they are becoming useful products for the betterment of whole universe, then it's a quality education, which that parameter we also included into this one. Then in between we have discussed third issue, we have discussed that how internationalization of our education it has to be, and how multidisciplinary activities in the education it has to be added, so that the overall development of the students will be far, far better. Again, it will be better exposure to the students, better confidence level of the students, some Indian universities may be going outside India. They'll be establishing their campuses outside India. Some of the top universities of the world, they'll be coming in India. They'll be establishing some healthy competition we'll be having in the country, and huge money which is being flooding to European countries from India for the purpose of higher education. Probably we'll be able to attract some of good students from some better countries in our country, and some of our students may be getting same facilities which topmost universities in the world, they are going outside. Even in India it will be available. So again, it is related to that quality education also. In between, we have discussed the issue of what exactly we had our Indian knowledge system in past, teachers training and values in education. So values, when we are saying confidence building of teachers, we are saying then certainly the issue of equity and issue of quality, we are discussing into that one. And the accountability is also, it's a very, very important. Accountability means what expectations society is having, in what way institutes are able to prove. Even huge funding, huge support is being given by Government of India. Certainly, when fundings institutes are getting, they should be accountable also, that the target which has been given to them or expectation of the government or society which it is there, are they able to fulfill or not? That accountability part, it is also there. In Indian knowledge system, we are having a separate cell now. MHRD has established one separate cell. It will be in AICT. And what exactly we were doing in science, in languages, in technology, in past, in metal science, in any area which today we are observing, which may be having lot of relevance, in what way those areas can be connected with modern education. So better employability of the students, better innovative entrepreneurship abilities of the students can be, and how that knowledge can be utilized in present context. And just yesterday we have discussed about how assessment of the students, it has to be in what way intensive, it has to be treatment to be implemented, and how employability announcement of the students, it has to be. Certainly all the topics which you have discussed, all are relevant to what we'll be discussing today. So access is important. If anyone who is willing to enter into this higher education, the facility should be available for into the education system. Their capabilities may be different, some concept of personalized learning, some concept of stressing towards individual attention of the teachers. All 60 students who have entered into the class, they may be equal in one case. Another case, all 60 may be different. In third case, there may be 3-4 varieties of the students, different categories may be. So one is equality, another one is equity. There is a difference. Equality means, as a teacher, I'm observing that all these students are at the same level. In equity, when we are saying the categories of these students are different, and the way they have been groomed into their families, that is also different. The regional differences, and the languages differences, the social differences, the financial differences which are available. So in equity, we are saying for individual strength, what effort we people can do, so that when they'll be going out, more or less everyone should be at the same level. So access part, equity part, then quality part, then affordability, the per capita income of the country, if you see, huge varieties, it is available. Roughly 30% population we are having who are earning less than $3 per day. That sort of the population we are having. And our, particularly our higher education, we are saying 90% it is operated by private people. Certainly, whatever cost they are having on education, it is coming through fee only. No government support, it is there. So it is very difficult to enter into this higher education by ordinary children who is having quite backward background, or socially backward background, or financially backward background. So in what way those children can be made allowed into this higher education? So affordability of every student can be of great use. Yes. And then the next two topics we'll be having tomorrow, day after tomorrow, that will be related to vocational education and how it can be more transparent. So first of all, Sandeep Sanjati Saab, I'll be coming to you. Enormous, enormous exposure you are having of this education, starting from NIT system, then Manipal, SRM, many, many groups you have handled, huge education system you are handling, as well as enormous expectation society is having from people like you, who are having this much of exposure. So my first question from you, that is related to quality. Forget about access, equity, everything. Our quality of this education should be ensured so that acceptance of our graduate, not only in our Indian conditions, anywhere in the world, because it's a young population, very large base of young population we are having, how this young population can be made confident, competent enough so that they should be able to deliver in any corner of the world. What effort it has to be done according to this new education policy, so the quality should be ensured. The document is very good. Everyone is appreciating the vision. This one, how this policy in terms of imparting quality education, how it has to be implemented, those words of wisdom we would like to listen from you.
Thank you. Thank you, Punia Saab. Thank you, Rajiv Kumar Saab, Colonel Bansal, everyone, for this opportunity. Very happy to join the distinguished panel of experts who are also going to share their views on this important subject of access, equity, affordability, accountability, various other things of importance. We know that we have been pursuing this not for now, at least for last 2 decades, that we are very aggressively talking about quality. Many of us are aware of some of the initiatives which were with the name quality itself, like quality improvement program did appear for the teachers. Then we also had the event like or a scheme like TechCube, Technical Education Quality Improvement Program. So that was specifically for that. So quality has been at fore in terms of what we need to do. It's important. It's established already. And in that sense, I would say NEP has re-emphasized all these points which are there. But I would also say that in today's context, we need to do maybe a little bit more to these 5 aspects of access, equity, affordability, accountability, and quality. And that would be in form of speed, efficiency, and diversity. And I'm saying so because I have had an exposure of government institutions as well as the private institutions. And I find that there is some dichotomy, or there is some difference there. The speed at which the decisions can be taken, whether to close a program or to start a program, or whether to retain a faculty or not to, or to change their direction, I think that may be something in terms of maybe speed. Efficiency also counts sometimes, as we some of us know. And another thing is diversity. Now, diversity is going to answer the quality aspect. Right now, what we are doing with our teaching learning is we teach students what we want to teach, rather than students learn what they want to learn. And when I'm imposed with something that I have to do it forcibly, my heart will not be into it. I'll probably avoid it, minimize it, or just get the required grades and say, okay, I'm done. But I'm not fully into it. When I'm fully into it, the quality will happen. I think I can possibly say the same thing for my teachers also. I give you the example of students. If I say the example of teachers, I'll say the same thing. Right now, we are mostly having shortage of teacher in most of the institutions, particularly so in government. And we know that courses are framed 2 years in advance, and then a new teacher comes in and he's given something to teach, because whatever is available is is given. Some good institutions will, of course, have good practices to support them. But generally what happens is a teacher is forced to teach some subjects initially where he or she may not be very comfortable. That means what is happening is he starts making compromises, or he starts making something where neither he is comfortable nor his students is comfortable, and that becomes the foundation. I think we have to change that philosophy where the courses are offered because the institution has decided. The courses should be offered based on the teachers who are available. For example, all the experts who go from India to outside, let's say to AIT Bangkok, or as a Fulbright scholar coming from US to India, They say, this is my expertise. I'm going to deliver these courses. And once that is there, then the students flock them and study that. I have experienced both of them. And therefore, I'm saying that it should be based on the expertise of the teacher rather than based on what we just want to deliver for sake of delivery. So quality has many, many angles. Quality, as we know, cannot be easily be measured. It's not very easily quantifiable, though we are trying to do certain things in terms of outcomes and outputs and various other things which are there. Quality obviously is a continuous journey. Today, whatever I have set as a standard will be changed as a standard tomorrow. But I must say that quality can come once we decide, the stakeholders decide the fate of what they want to do. And therefore, that aspect of two aspects, I'll just say, which will be important for me for quality. Number one is the autonomy. And that's where I gave you the example of a student and the teacher. A teacher will teach the subjects where he is good at. A student will study the subjects which he wants to learn rather than which is imposed on learn. And therefore, I would possibly say autonomy is very important. Autonomy is something, in my opinion, cannot be given, has to be taken, which many of us don't understand in educational setup. We still keep going to our bosses saying, can I do this? Can you approve this? Possibly to save our skin or possibly to see that we are not violating any regulatory aspect or whatever. We are not bold enough to absorb what we call autonomy and that therefore the decision making. So we have to make sure this autonomy, which has been re-emphasized in the new education policy, percolates down to the lowest level. It should not come to the institution only. It should go to VC. It should go to deans, directors, HODs, lab in charges, project in charges, everyone, and finally to the students also. Level may be different, extent may be different, region of operation may be different. That will bring quality, in my opinion. And with quality, of course, accountability or with autonomy, accountability is there, as Punyasa was saying. And you are accountable for what you want to study, and therefore you will make it good. When I have taken decision, I'll make it good and my quality will be good. So that's one aspect of the quality, I would say. Autonomy will bring more quality. The second and most important for that is probably all of us have adopted to it already, and we call it education 4.0, or we call it technology-driven education, or what has happened due to COVID. I think I'm a big fan of technology, and I'm sure all of you who are sitting here, at least from AICT, are from the technology background, so you understand what I'm trying to say. Suppose I'm coming from a village. I don't have access to IIT coaching. I don't have access to any competitive preparation, also examination preparation. I still want to learn something from IIT. Today, even if I don't take admission in IIT, I can learn from IIT teachers or IIM teachers or any other teachers. Same way, I may be in city in India, but I have a dream to learn some subjects from Oxford or Stanford. I can do the same thing. So technology is going to be a big thing. Imagine in India, we have a biggest difficulty in terms of teachers and both quantity and quality. Quality is much bigger challenge. Quantity is also a challenge. The number of teachers are not available in many institutions. And this void can be covered up by the technology itself, in my opinion. Wherever there is a void, technology, in my opinion, is a slave. Technology is a donkey which can be made to work in a certain way. Technology will keep repeating something. Suppose I have a class of electronics here in SRM where I'm right now, and I'm supposed to teach two or three sections or four sections, let's say. After doing my first lecture, when I try to repeat the same lecture, the intensity will not be the same, and maybe the repetition would not be the same, effective repetition, examples and all that. And therefore, if I use technology, I'm still available to do Q&A and maybe interact with them, but I don't have to repeat it four times. I think I can deliver it to thousands of students. I just give you an example of a professor from New South Wales University, whom I met last year in US in Microsoft conference. He was a young person of 30 years of age. He says he takes a class of 600 students, 500 to 600, and he's using AI and various other tools which Microsoft had developed and given to him. And he says that he is able to give personal attention to all the students. Thereby, he was meaning that if someone is slow moving, he is giving different problems. If someone is fast moving, trying to bring them on track rather than pushing the same dose everywhere. I think quality requires many such experiments, in my opinion, to improve. One size fits all will not be quality. Quality will be depending upon the situation, case, people, person, aspirations, whatever. And we have seen quality has to be many small efforts in many, many different directions. I think I must here give credit to TechCube, the World Bank program, which benefited large number of engineering institutions and polytechnic institutions to seed many, many good practices to lead us towards quality, whether we require mentoring, whether we require openness, whether we require corpuses, whether we require new evaluation methodologies, whether we have to be having independent board. I'm very happy that NEP is saying that you'll have independent boards and boards will re-elect the boards. I think those are good things, and those have come from some of the quality seeds which were sown some 20 years back seriously, but I'm sure previously also it was there. But quality is something which will continue, Punia Saab, even in the next education policy. This would not be a theme which can be dropped easily from there anywhere, because quality is not a destination. Quality is just a milestone, in my opinion, and will keep traversing that particular path to reach the quality. It might be, in a sense, mirage that you look at big things and you try to reach at those big things. Hopefully, we'll reach soon under this NEP 2020. This is my initial take on quality. Thank you.
Sandeep ji, wonderful. So just 2 minutes I'll be taking of yours. For quality, the understanding which we had now, that access of quality teachers, it has to be access to conducive environment of learning, it has to be. As per the Sandeep Sancheti's model, one is the dream which you are having that this should be there, that is one part. I want to understand your model, that this are done in SRM, this are done in Manipal, and that's why I achieved this level of quality. What are those three steps, in fact, which you have implemented, you have experimented, and you have got the success? So that immediately we can request to Government of India that these type of success models are available. These type of experiments, already it has been done, and they have got the success. It is Professor Sandeep Sancheti's model. In what way we can recommend to MHRD that from tomorrow itself we should try this one, and it's a well-tested model.
Examples from SRM and one from Manipal. Of course, there can be many from NITs where I served for a long time. But in these domains, it's rather easy to implement certain things. Number one, I started a program in SRM called FIIP, Faculty Industry Immersion Program. During summers or winters, whenever there is an adequate holidays or break, for up to 15 days, we'll send the faculty to industry from our side, everything paid, transport, living cost, everything. There will be no cost to the industry. There will be no cost to the faculty also. Faculty only goes there through a contact, enriches himself or herself by what industry is doing, what problems they are facing, what tools and tackles they have, establishes a contact, and creates a bridge between institution and the industry. With that, when they come back, they make a small presentation, what they saw, what they want, and automatically in those 15 days, whatever they learn, it goes into their teaching, it goes into their projects they are floating, it goes into the research they want to promote. And therefore, now because they have lived with them for 10, 15 days, they are able to easily able to call each other and therefore share things. And that's how we make a permanent bridge with the industry. Making bridge with students is also good, but students vanish again with the jobs and they no more remain with us. And therefore, we have developed this particular method. Industry is very happy. Faculty are also very happy. They get a change and they don't get that stigma that you don't know anything about industry. That stigma is gone from their head that, oh, I've never seen an industry. You are not a very practical person. So that's one good thing which we have implemented for changing the quality. And you know that automatically the internships will come, automatically the placements will come, automatically the real life problems will come. That is one thing. The second thing which we all emphasize and which is again done in SRM is the research. Research is a focus for us. Research is make our name, brand, popularity, and of course rankings and ratings, particularly in the QS and THE, those top 100 and 200 which we are wanting. How do we promote research? Not by just by saying that we promote research. We know that many of us have more craving for research and maybe not good teachers. Many of us are good teachers and not much craving for research. Vice versa, both are required. Both are important integral part of our education. And therefore, I would say that there we have created a new model called Research Institute within the setup. The rule there is you will get at the most one subject to teach. You will get associated with one department or maybe more than one department if you wish. But you will do more of research. You will drive research. You will write projects. You will get funding. You will drive PhD programs, excite others into research, connect with industry. And I'm very happy to tell you, I don't have a metallurgy department here, but we have done gold for Titan, Tata's gold. They sell it in the name of SRM. They say that it's a SRM gold kind of a thing. So I'm saying that though we do not have that department, but still we took people who can do materials research, and therefore we are able to drive research. So that's a good model. Faculty is more free and they are getting their taste, what they want to do, rather than they are forced into teaching 12 or 14 hours or routine things which are there. So research institute model is good. Let's keep both of them together in our universities because both are needed, academics and research. We are primarily focusing on academics right now, which is not good. So I appreciate that model. The third model, I'll take it from Manipal, Jaipur, where I did it. And I must say that it was probably North India's second liberal arts program, which I did it there. And I'm trying to establish similar kind of things here in SRM right now. And this liberal arts, I need not explain much, but I could possibly pick cherries from best of the possible places, young and old alike, and bring the department together, and which was thriving and doing very well. Now this has come into the form of the scheme where both myself and Professor Puniaji had contributed initially, and the scheme is called ABC, Academic Bank of Credit. So one is the institutions offer them what choices you want within a given frame of subjects which I'm doing, like let's say electronics or mechanical. I may not like one odd subject. I should be allowed not to go through that unless it's very, very essential. And I should be taking a direction which I want. ABC gives full direction to the students. And that is the beautiful thing. And in a way, some good institutions in India have tried to implement it. Manipal is where I did that as well. And that is how I would say quality will come to the fore if we allow these kind of experiments in our education system. Thank you.
Big success for the program to come. And wherever best education is available, where best teachers are available, best curriculum is available, your students can earn some of the credits from that place, from another place, according to that boys or girls' choice, that possibility is also there. And certainly it will be leading to improvement in quality and confidence level of the student. Wonderful. Access is when student has not entered into the institute, when he is dreaming, in fact. But when question of equity is coming, when he has entered into the institute and the type of learning which will be taking place, it will depend upon what sort of facilities we are giving to them, because every children is different. And particularly Indian-like conditions, there is wide diversity, huge diversity it is available. Dr. Rakesh Sharma Sahab, students has entered into your university. Yes. New education policy is saying that equity is very, very important, particularly personalized attention. Shortcomings in their languages, some cultural differences are there. The difference of IQ, the understanding, even homesick, the type of environment which we are providing. So equity, in fact, the personalized, even the resources which are available into the institute, some of these students may not be needing those many resources they may not be needing. They are very good in library. One friend is there, even he is having all sort of facilities on the mobile. He may not be needing all sort of books. One another children who is from the remotest village, he left to provide some 10 books separately from the library. So that resources which are there, even that treatment also according to the needs of the student, that resources also it has to be distributed. So first of all, the personalized concept, personalized in terms of approach. Second was the resources which we are having, the distribution of the resources
to those children, and even on the basis of the cultural differences which are there, how they should be given that push, in fact, so that after certain time there should be equilibrium among all these friends, understanding level should become same. So for improving this equity, what are your suggestion? Because this policy equality targeting access as well as equity also. Why I am saying equity, particularly in distance learning? In distance learning, if you see the result of SC/ST category, distance ODL, this mechanism of education, the results are only 20 to 25%, because examination pattern is same, question paper is same, curriculum is same. Any student, whatever background they are having, they have to go through the same level of the situation. So in that case, because personalized learning concept is not there, there is no concept of adaptive learning. Everyone will have to do same level of solution of the papers they have to give. So results are very, very poor. In what way academic results can improve? The chances of enhancing the employability can improve, and even pressure on the students can be reduced by improving this concept of into the campuses.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Punya sir. First of all, I must thank you that you considered me capable and competent enough to be a part of this panel discussion. To be honest, I'll be forthcoming and telling that I'm probably the only one who is not from the field of technical education or education. I have been in educational administration only, so probably I'll be sitting here learning more than what I'll be able to contribute. Am I audible, sir?
Very clear, very clear.
Sir, you raised an issue of equity. Sir, now equity, you yourself raised two issues also. Equity of the treatment which is being given to students and the faculty members, I'll include, even though you didn't say so, by the management and environment where there is an equitable treatment, and then equitable delivery of the education, that also is very important for the students. So fortunately, I have an experience of, per chance it is, that I happened to lead an organization known as Navodaya Vidyalaya Samiti, where probably there could not have been a better example of a government institution where this issue of equity and access both, they have been addressed to wonderfully well. Probably there cannot be one. Give me just a minute to explain what Navodaya is. There's one Navodaya school in every district, and that Navodaya school, when it admits students based on a competitive examination to class 6, these are residential schools. So the reservation of seats is available block-wise. Every block has certain reservation of seats, keeping in view the proportion block. I'm not saying district. Every district has a school, and then the reservation is block-wise. Then from every block, one-third girls, one-third boys, and then from one-third girls, boys, you have to have equitable proportion presence of SC, ST, OBC. So there could not be a better system where the issue of equity has been addressed. And likewise, there could not have been a better system of addressing the access to quality school education, because we have located one in every district, Manipur, Nagaland, Tripura. Everywhere you will find a Navodaya school everywhere. And another thing which happened after I left the organization in 2006 was reinforcing this intention of the government to build up the concept of access and equality. When they established more than, normally the policy was only one school, because these are very costly schools costing around 20 crore rupees per district. But then government realized somewhere in 2006, yes, there are a few special economic zones with higher proportion of SC and ST and poor population. They allowed the second school to be established. So that is my background of having dealt access and equity while working in a government setup. So far as an equality of treatment is concerned, already there are so many. How should an institution achieve it? Equality will boil down not only to SC, ST, OBC, probably it will relate to gender equity also. All those things are important. So government and AICT, UGC, UFs are already put in place. Many suggestions you have suggested, the constitution of many committees, internal complaint committee to take care of gender related issues, and many other students grievances committee, etc., etc. So if an institution is able to put in place all the mechanisms which have been suggested by these regulatory bodies and governments, and in many cases by honorable courts, and can efficiently manage those committees. Note that the committees exist only on papers, which happens in many cases. So if these are functional, these are effectively functioning, probably the issue of equality in treatment, it will never arise. It will just not take place. But still, there can be issues. And then the institution has to be very sensitive in addressing any such issue if it is raised. Having spent around 10 to 15 years, rather more than that, probably more in educational administration, including one in government of Himachal Pradesh, where I happened to be the Secretary of Education, I found that such issues, they keep arising. And wherever the local principal has taken care of them, the issues have been nipped in the bud. Not that, and one another thing, I can quote many examples, but I'll not sound elaborative here. Where if a teacher, a principal tried to bury them deep somewhere, ki acha kahin shikayat na ho jaye, government ko na pata chal jaye. The moment he did so, he was not successful for long. This sprouted in a big tree. So most important thing, sir, is to put in place these mechanisms and ensuring that these mechanisms, these bodies, they function very effectively. And then, sir, I think you as an AICT, as a regulatory body, will always have, you cannot lose your responsibility of monitoring us, monitoring institutions on that aspect. Probably you have some parameters in your self-disclosure. I'll suggest you also to strengthen and to those further to ensure that institutions, they don't divert, they don't deviate on that issue. So coming to equality and distribution in the delivery of academics is concerned, I don't see any reason. Probably I have never come across any institution, at least a higher education institution, when such issue ever arose. Students are sitting in the same class. It can always happen that a teacher who is not very aware of the sensitivities associated with the issues of equity and access, probably he may err as an individual, but systems will never err. I have never seen any institutions. Again, the responsibility will vest with the institutions to take care of such aberration, such issues, if they ever come to notice. This is one.
Rakeshji, I'll be intervening here. Sir. When I'm saying equity, it means the difference of the capabilities of the students. There is a difference between the capabilities of the students. Some of them may be having background of Hindi background. They may be having problems with languages. Some of them may not have got the opportunity to study in a good school. They'll be having problems in the classes. So if 60 students are there, there may be 5-6 categories in the class. How teacher handle on a personal basis, how he is giving attention on personal basis, so everyone, yes.
So what we done here?
I'll be differentiating between equality and equity. Equality means level of ability is same. There is no question of any differentiation between different groups. But when equity is there, because in our country there is wide diversity, it is available, huge diversity. The background of the students will be coming in the classes, their background is different. So it will depend upon the capabilities of the teacher, that how he handles that type of situation, so that everyone feel elevated and everyone feels that yes, some response is given to my shortcomings or strengths which I am having.
Sir, here the... We have the responsibility, the onus of responsibility in my view, and I'll share the experiences also at Graphic Right, vests again with the teacher, because you have again put in many mechanisms, many through this induction program, you tell us through accreditation criteria, there are many criteria in NACAS also, NBA, where you seek from us as to what are the practices in place to identify weak students, to segregate them from fast learners, how we are able to bridge those gaps. All those things are very, the concerns are very well known. The concern is simple, that the students who have some learning handicap, they must be identified, they must be incapacitated through a bridge course, so that before the regular classes start, or within a month or two, they are at the same common learning levels. That is very, very important, sir. Now, it will again, you see, mentor-mentor relationships is a concept which is there in existence since last many years. But important is, sir, can I take a call? My chairman is there just for a minute, sir. Just not more than a minute, sir.
Please.
Hello. A meeting of the government where we are supposed to attend it tomorrow. So sir, teacher, the onus of responsibility shall lie with the teacher too. And the opportunity is always available with the teacher if he is, as you told me, the teacher is very important. Professor Sandeep Chanthesh is also, he also spoke about the capabilities of a teacher. If a teacher is a genuine teacher, if he knows what are his responsibilities as a teacher, what his job profile includes besides teaching as a teacher, as a loco parenti, as Honorable Supreme Court said in one case, that a teacher is not only a teacher, he's a guru, and above guru, he's a parent also. I have often heard you saying that a teacher has the responsibility as a parent. You have also told, I've heard you a number of times. So if he's aware of his, that job profile of his, interacting with the teacher day in and day out in the class with the students, also in the playground, in hostels, at many other platforms, it is not difficult for a teacher to identify what are the specific deficiencies, who are the weak students, not only learning. There may be few students who are very good at studies, they are not weak, but then they are not so confident, they lack communication skills because they have come from Hindi background. Probably they are finding it difficult to follow the classes being conducted in English. So responsibility lies with the student in graphic era, with the teacher. Again, graphic era, what we are doing, sir, is we have a very, very effective mentor-mentor relationship. Around 20 to 30 students are being given to every teacher. There is a structure, a strategy. Every student has to be spoken to by the mentor teacher at least once in 50 days. Spoken to means he has to be spoken to. He has to keep a record. Earlier we used even to keep a record of the when did he call, from which number he called, which number he called, and then the faculty told me, sir, believe us, it is not required. But that was a sort of stringency we once had 2 years back. But there is a register where mentor records when he spoke and what were the specific deficiencies or problems which were pointed out, which were shared by the student, what was done to address to those needs. So this is one thing, sir. And then bridge courses are very important, sir. I'll again share you example of a very small college where I used to go, where we found that many students, they're so poor in mathematics and physics that this handicap, it keeps accompanying them as an appendix for four years down the line till the time he completes BTEC. He leaves with a strong handicap of mathematics, physics, and then all related capabilities which can be acquired only if you have some strength in those courses. We decided, I advised them, there were few more, that why don't you call those students a month in advance. They were called a month in advance, and believe me, sir, we had an impression that parents will not send, but parents did send their wards once we were able to explain, look, this is our objective of calling them a month in advance. We taught them only physics and mathematics. It is a college in Ghaziabad, and the results were tremendous. The results in terms of pass percentage only, I can say, probably improved from 50 to 80%. So the equity, and that way, the institution's responsibility is to put in place mechanisms as also to monitor it. The responsibility will lie with the teachers, sir. That is where the capacity building of teachers becomes very important. When you are saying autonomy is the word used by Professor Sancheti ji, autonomy of teachers, sir, autonomy comes with certain strengths. Autonomy is not something which I'll enjoy if I am not capable, if I don't know how to use the autonomy. Autonomy will require certain capability, certain capacity building, and that also is important. And council can probably rather should think of having some structured programs, faculty development programs, where such traits can be inculcated in the faculty. So probably I'll stop here, sir, on this issue.
Very good. Yes, wonderful.
Wonderful.
Again, the issue of access. Education should be available for everyone. In our new education policy, up to 2030, in schools, now the education which they divided, it is in four parts. First 5 years up to class second, then next 3 years up to class fifth, that is preparatory phase. Next one is middle, again 3 years up to class eighth, ninth, 10th, 11th, 12th, it is secondary education. And now as per this new education policy, in secondary education, there will be one board examination, there won't be much compartments. Vocational education will start from class 6, the hands-on part of the students will be much better in that case. The multidisciplinary approaches will be there. It's also being changed. It is only on the basis of the outcomes, what they are able to deliver, what they are able to do on that basis. It is being done, and it is now as per this new education policy up to 2030, the gross enrollment ratio in class 12th, it should be 100%. Means every children who who is in the age group of 18 to 23 years, they'll be having class 12 certificate. Anyone who is in that age group, he'll be having this opportunity to have that education. But in our new education policy, same time, up to 2035, in higher education, the gross enrollment ratio up to 2035, I said up to 2030, in secondary education, the gross enrollment ratio will be 100%. In higher education, up to 2035, the gross enrollment ratio has to become 50%. Eligible students, 50% of that one will be getting the opportunity to enter into higher education. At level of this gross enrollment ratio, we are lucky, in fact, that for male and female, more or less GR is same. Average is, say, 26.9%, 6.3%. Out of that one, female, the ratio is 25.6%. More or less, the male and female in gross enrollment ratio, it is same. But the problem which is coming in backward categories like SC, ST, especially in ST category. In ST category, our enrollment ratio is only 15.9%. Very, very less gross enrollment ratio it is there. And it is the effort of the Government of India. Not after this new education policy from 2018, Ministry of Human Resource Development, then Ministry, they have started to give importance, particularly for enhancing the gross enrollment ratio of this SC, ST category. 30,000 crores provision it has been kept. In that 30,000 crores, special efforts, first of all, special hostel facilities in the vicinity for the students, it has to be available so that at least they can stay there, because that itself is a daunting task for the students. If they are entering into higher education, some facility for comfortable stay, it has to be. Second one, some concept of model colleges, that in that particular region, in the neighborhood, model colleges where quality education, even in mother tongue, it has to be given. And on that one, 1,000 crores provision, it has been kept on this one. Third, what concept of this Kendriya Vidyalaya, Navodaya Vidyalaya, and you said in every district that Navodaya Vidyalaya, Kendriya Vidyalaya, and then some government infrastructure, developed infrastructure, it is available. So utilizing that infrastructure for the purpose of this online education, because there is a gross difference between the facilities related to IT infrastructure is concerned in rural area and urban area, there is a huge difference. So they are saying some certain common centers will be made into this Kendriya Vidyalaya and Navodaya Vidyalaya and in government infrastructure, so that students can come there and they can take the benefit of that online education also. So many, many efforts are being done for improving the access of the education. Bansal Saab, VK Bansal Ji, your ideas, because you are the public servant, you are IAS officer, you are knowing the ground reality of the society. Now situation, you may be starting some 5 years back, 3 years back, as GDP of the country is growing, the technologies are coming, we are becoming one of the leading country in the world. Now situation at ground level also it is changing. According to you, for improving the access in education, particularly in higher education, at 37 million studying in higher education, now in time to come in 2035, it will be somewhere around 70 million students in that higher education. Now when these many students will be coming, has to be available. Even Sandeep Sancheti ji, Dr. Rakesh, they were saying there is a bottleneck related to teachers is needed, the soft infrastructure in terms of teachers also it has to be needed. When we'll be having access, then the entry into institutes like yours, where more or less your financial viability is coming through free, in these type of institutes, when students are entering, in what way government can help, in what way government can motivate, so that more and more students can take the benefit of this quality some help from the government so that they can take the benefit of this one. What should be done?
Sir, thank you so very much. I'm grateful that I have been given time to speak at this esteemed panel. And I'm extremely grateful to you. You have been always very kind. AICT has always been very, very supportive. If I could understand correctly, because there was some disturbance when you were speaking.
सबका कैसे गड़बड़ हो सकता है उनका यार?
Hello. Can you please hear me?
Yes. Please continue. Please continue.
Thank you. तो सर मेरा ये कहना है कि कुछ एक जैसे आज की डेट में हर एक इवन छोटी से छोटी बात, फॉर्चुनेटली अवर प्राइम मिनिस्टर इज प्रमोटिंग ऑन द सोशल मीडिया. प्राइम मिनिस्टर आई बीन टेलिंग द अदर डे टू माय पीपल कि अभी तक आप मार्किंग के लिए कोटलर करे जाते हो. ऐसे अगर मेरे बस में चले तो मैं मार्केटिंग की किताब बाइबल से नरेंद्र मोदी को कोट करो आप. तो द थिंग इज के हम लोग फ्यूचरिस्टिक, मैंने पिछले दिनों आई विल नॉट नेम द कॉलेजेस, हिंदुस्तान के कुछ एक प्रीमियर इंस्टीट्यूशंस का एमबीए का करिकुलम करा एंड आई राइज के उसमें अगर कुछ फ्यूचरिस्टिक है तो दैट हैज बीन ओनली एडेड एज सम स्पेशल मॉड्यूल बट इट हैज नॉट बीन एम्बेडेड इनटू देयर करिकुलम्स और द प्रोग्राम्स. क्योंकि स्टूडेंट बहुत ब्राइट है, स्टूडेंट 99% है, 95% वाला बच्चा आ रहा है. तो परहैप्स समवेयर नंबर वन माय रिक्वेस्ट इज दैट AICT has been coming forward with lot of model curriculum, with so many online MOOCs and other things. AICT has also been rightly saying, new education policy has also been saying, कि उनके बेस के आप आपको 15% या 25% mandate करना चाहिए. That is the right thinking. But somewhere down the line, institutions have to be putting the futuristic goal and futuristic targets into the curriculum. They have to be linking with that, and government is requested to kindly guide or support, or maybe I would even go to the extent of saying monitor on those lines. We are grateful, we are very happy, we have seen the changing face of the AICTE. AICT today is a great facilitator, which it never was. It never was. So, but कई बार लगता है कि कुछ एक issues के ऊपर, जैसे curriculum, futuristic curriculum की बात है, और मैं इस वजह से भी I'm making this submission, क्योंकि मुझे डॉक्टर कस्तूरी रंगन जी को होस्ट करने के 3 मौके मिले. Invited him to our college campus at the Founders Day 2 years back. Hamara sara board of directors and several industrialists ko maine unse milaya aur hamari unse ek hi maine jo unko sujhav diya ki we le ke sujhav diye ki hum jo bhi padhate hain uska ultimate evaluator to एंड यूजर होना चाहिए. मैंने पढ़ाया, मैंने ही एग्जाम ले लिया, दैट्स अ डिफरेंट थिंग कि मैं कह रहा हूँ कि किसी और टीचर ने पेपर सेट कर दिया या किसी और यूनिवर्सिटी ने पेपर सेट कर दिया. एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर सारी फॉर 37.5 years आई हैव सर्व्ड द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया. मैं केवल ये चाह रहा हूँ, ये रिक्वेस्ट कर रहा हूँ कि हम ये जो प्रोडक्ट जिस बंदे के लिए तैयार कर रहे हैं, वो बंदा मेरे प्रोडक्ट को देखे, सर्टिफाई करे, तभी मुझे डिग्री मिलनी चाहिए. दे शुड बी लर्निंग द करिकुलम के रिक्वायरमेंट है क्या, एंड ऑल ऑफ अस एज इन द एकेडेमिया शुड बी वर्किंग इन दैट डायरेक्शन. और यही रिक्वेस्ट मैंने फिर कस्तूरी रंगन जी के सामने एज चेयरमैन ऑफ दी पीएचडी चेंबर ऑफ कॉमर्स एजुकेशन कमेटी दो प्रेजेंटेशन दी उनको. ऑल ऑफ अस नो लिमिट NEP committee also. We have been part of the bureaucracy. We know the limitations also. So, despite all the limitations, I must say that end user has given me one request. From the government, from the regulators. Number two है कि जितना आप AICTE आज की डेट में you are going to schools, you are going to colleges, you are conducting events and webinars like the one we are doing today. जितनी awareness AICTE ने कोशिश करी है create करने की that is very remarkable, very very remarkable. But as an end user, मेरी एक और ये feeling है that most of it is still not reaching most of the students. This is reaching those students who have already entered the colleges and who have already entered the universities. पर जो students अभी college और university में enter नहीं करे उनको ये तकरीबन 80-90% चीजों की खबर नहीं है. And they are still being guided by the coaching centers. So that is number two thing. I'm sure the government is keeping an eye. And one more thing I would like to say, that being chairman of the PhD Chamber Education Committee, we have started now connecting with Indian embassies overseas. और पिछले दिनों वी कंडक्टेड वन वर्कशॉप अलोंग विद द कॉन्सल जनरल टोरंटो फॉर यूनिवर्सिटीज इन कैनेडा अप्राइजिंग देम ऑफ द न्यू एजुकेशन पॉलिसी टेलिंग देम ऑफ द ग्रेट अपॉर्चुनिटीज दैट दे ऑल कैन हैव इन आवर ग्रेट कंट्री ऑफ इंडिया एंड आई ओनली वांट टू टेल द ऑनरेबल Vice Chairman, that there is tremendous anxiety, there is tremendous information gap, education policy in the minds of universities overseas. So, मैंने अपनी तरफ से कोशिश कर रहा हूँ मैं that on the platform of PhD Chamber. We are trying to connect with the educational institutions overseas through the ambassadors and consul generals and high commissioners. So that one thing is also necessary because most of the universities, even if they are getting interested, unko yahan pe kaise, how do they come and put up their campuses over here? What exactly will they have to be doing? Kitni ease of business hogi? और उसमें से उनको अल्टीमेटली क्या लॉन्ग टर्म या शॉर्ट टर्म एडवांटेजेस या डिफिकल्टीज होंगी इन चीज़ों के बारे में उनके मन में काफ़ी सवाल हैं जो उनको अभी क्लैरिटी नहीं है विच आई ए मेंशनड एज ए चैम्बर वी आर ट्राइंग टू डू इट बट दीज आर कपल ऑफ थिंग्स द रेगुलेटर्स और द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया मे ऑल्सो लाइक टू कंसिडर एंड आई एम एक्सट्रीमली ग्रेटफुल फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू बी पार्ट ऑफ द greatest intellectuals and academicians of the country. Thank you very much, sir.
आपसे जो आपसे सुनना चाहता हूँ क्वालिटी ऑफ एजुकेशन इज वन पार्ट एक्सेप्टेंस ऑफ स्टूडेंट्स दैट इज सेकंड पार्ट मैं आपसे ये सुनना चाहता हूँ कि इन आवर कंट्री ग्रोस एनरोलमेंट रेशियो इज वेरी लो ओनली 26% स्टूडेंट्स हु आर विलिंग टू ज्वाइन हायर एजुकेशन दे आर गेटिंग द अपॉर्चुनिटी इस एक्सेस को बढ़ाने के लिए बिकॉज यू आर पार्ट ऑफ दिस हायर एजुकेशन सिंस इयर्स क्वालिटी एजुकेशन यू आर एबल टू प्रोवाइड हाउ वी कैन अट्रैक्ट मोर एंड मोर स्टूडेंट्स फ्रॉम आवर कंट्री सो दैट हायर एजुकेशन कैन बी स्ट्रेंथन्ड country will grow only if our higher education will be strong and more students will be entering into this higher education. Huge infrastructure in the country, it has been created, but no takers are available.
You're very right, sir. You're very, very right.
The seats
sir.
Are vacant. So yeah. How we can attract more and more students to this higher education?
सर उसका तो एक ही आंसर है सर कि उसी के लिए मैंने जैसे पहले सबमिशन करी कि हम जो पढ़ा रहे हैं वो रिक्रूटर को जॉब प्रोवाइडर को चाहिए कि नहीं चाहिए. द स्टूडेंट कम्स टू यू ओनली इफ दे आर आई डोंट से अश्योर्ड बट दे हैव अ फीलिंग कि ये करने के बाद या तो चार पैसे खुद कमाने लग जाएगा या उसको चार पैसे की नौकरी मिल जाएगी. सर द डिफिकल्टीज दैट सो मेनी इंस्टीट्यूशंस मे बी फार फ्लंग एरियाज में है या दे आर नॉट बीइंग प्रॉपरली मैनेज्ड. उन जगह के जब वो बच्चे ग्रेजुएट्स का जो पास आउट का हाल या हुलिया देखते हैं सो दैट बिकम्स अ बिग काइंड ऑफ डीमोटिवेटिंग फैक्टर फॉर देम बिकॉज उनको लगता है कि इस एजुकेशन करने की हमें ज़रूरत क्या है, इस एजुकेशन का हमें फ़ायदा क्या है. हम बैंक से लोन लेके पढ़ाई भी करेंगे पर ये पढ़ाई करके होगा क्या हमारा. तो जब तक सर न्यू एजुकेशन पॉलिसी ने कोशिश करी है उसको स्किल से लिंक करने की एंड जब तक वो स्किल मेरे हाथ में नहीं आएगा, स्किल पढ़ाने से केवल कुछ नहीं होगा, स्किल जब तक वो हुनर मेरे हाथ में नहीं आएगा सर तब तक हमारे ऑल योर एफर्ट्स will not be able to give the desired result because parent jo gaon mein jisme bacche cha rahe hain engineer padh ke aate hain jis gaon mein char bacche mba karke aate hain us sare gaon ki us bacche se bahut bhari umeed hoti hai. hum bhi sir gaon se aaye hain, aap se aaye hain, aapko maloom hai ki jab bacche ko kisi higher institution mein higher education institution mein acche mein naukri usko admission milti hai to sare gaon ki keval parents ki nahi sare gaon ki kitni umeedein badh jati hain. इस वजह से जब तक एंड रिजल्ट से हम लिंक नहीं करेंगे कॉलेज की एजुकेशन को या हायर एजुकेशन को, द ग्रॉस इंडक्शन रेट इवन इफ इट इंक्रीजेस इट विल नॉट सर्व द पर्पस. तो आपने बिल्कुल ठीक करा एनईपी में कि किसी ने दो साल नहीं भी अगर करा, ये चार साल की इंजीनियरिंग नहीं भी करी, दे कैन एग्जिट एंड दे वुड बी गिवन सर्टिफिकेट्स. उसमें केवल दे शुड बी गिवन सर्टिफिकेट्स ऑफ एक्स वाई जेड स्किल्स दैट दे हैव लर्नड. इट विल बेस्ड ऑन द एक्स वाई जेड स्किल्स लर्नड बाय देम दैट दे वुड बी एम्प्लॉयबल एंड इसी से हायर एजुकेशन का रुतबा बढ़ेगा, रिक्वायरमेंट बढ़ेगी. अगर मैं केवल डिग्री जेब में लेके घूम रहा हूँ सर तो उससे कुछ नहीं होगा. इस वजह से माई स्किल्स अगेन हैव टू बी सर्टिफाइड नॉट बाय द टीचर हु इज गिविंग द स्किल. It has to be evaluated and certified by the end user. You will see the gross enrollment ratio will multiply in a very, very big way. I need to have confidence into the system कि ये करने के बाद मेरा भविष्य बदल जाएगा.
बंसल साहब, अभी जो पांच experts आप लोग आए हुए, all are autonomous as far as their institutes are concerned. Your institute in PGDM. Rakesh Sharma is Vice Chancellor of one of the very prominent university. Sandeep Sancheti Saab is Vice Chancellor of SRM University. Professor Basu from IIT Delhi. Rajiv Gandhi Vishwavidyalaya. All are autonomous.
Yes, sir.
In the conference building of the teachers, then why it is being said that ye hona chahiye, ye hona chahiye. Karne wale to aap log hai. Why it is not getting implemented and why it is not reflecting into the outcomes of the education? आप लोगों को कौन रोक रहा है?
आपने बिल्कुल सवाल ठीक पूछा सर. देखिए मुझे इस बात का फखर है कि जो मैं बात कह रहा हूँ वो बात हम कर रहे हैं इतने सालों से एंड मुझे कहने की जरूरत नहीं बिकॉज दिस इज वेरी वेरी ऑनरेबल प्लेटफॉर्म सर. एज ए आई सी टी ई आपने सर हमें 2017, 2018, 2019 में तीन सालों से आपने हमें अवार्ड करा है एज दी बेस्ट इंडस्ट्री लिंक कॉलेज ऑफ द कंट्री. तो सर मेरा तो जो करिकुलम है दैट इज वेरी थॉरली इवेल्यूएटेड एंड डिबेटेड बाई द इंडस्ट्री. मेरे examination papers are set in consultation with the industry. मेरे हर 15 दिनों बाद हर सैटरडे को पिछले 3 सैटरडे से भी ऑनलाइन पे हो रहा था. The students are being interviewed even in the first semester by the industry. कि सब्जेक्ट पे क्या लर्निंग हो रही है और उनकी जो शॉर्टकमिंग बताते हैं. वी टेल टू द स्टूडेंट अगेन, वी गिव देम टाइम ऑफ 2-3-4 वीक्स टू कम बैक, दैट वुड बी अगेन इवैल्यूएटेड. एंड सर, वी हैव टेकन सम सिमिलर स्टेप्स के देयर इज नो लाइक पास और फेल के. ठीक है, आपको 50 नंबर आ गए, 60 नंबर आ गए किसी सब्जेक्ट में, इन सम की सब्जेक्ट्स विच द इंडस्ट्री वांट्स. We have only said yes or no. If industry says कि मैं इस बच्चे को recruit कर लूँगी, जब industry कहती है, then we say yes, you're over. अगर नहीं हो रहा, then working at home. We say एक हफ्ते बाद, 15 दिनों बाद, 3 हफ्ते बाद, we'll keep working at home. जब आप पूरे तैयार हो जाएंगे, then we'll again call the industry recruiter. He will interview you and in the second semester, before the student faces the final interviewer. तो हम कोशिश ये कर रहे हैं सर कि जो हम बात कह रहे हैं उस बात को implementation की तरफ पूरी 100% कोशिश है. And we are very happy with our results, sir.
Professor Sunil.
Sir, yes. As far as my understanding is concerned,
just a minute. Country is having around 1,000 universities now.
Yeah.
1,000 colleges, 10,000 autonomous colleges. Like that, a huge education, higher education system we are having. But unfortunate part is there is imbalance in the sense, if 1,000 universities we are having, 700 are in urban areas. Out of 1,000, only 300 are in rural areas. The total population which country is having, 70% is residing in rural areas. But the facilities which are available, it is more in the urban areas. That is one part. Second one, again, the per capita income distribution, if you see, I said in initial remarks, roughly 25% population we are having who are earning less than $3 per day. And in higher education, if someone is entering, even in your university, someone is entering particular colleges which are affiliated to you, at least 1 lakh rupee it has to be spent by that children. He is taking loans from the bank, because in the family that much capacity is not available, so that they can send to that children in higher education. So they are taking loans. If two children simultaneously, there is a possibility from same family who are earning less than $3 per day, from same family, two children may be dreaming for entering into higher education. Out of two children, one may be dreaming for medical education. Then imagine what sort of pressure, what sort of financial pressure burden that family will be having. So difficult situation. Another part, 2 days back, 3 days back, when we have connected you, you said around 20,000 students are there in your university. Since years, they are having dream that I'll be getting degree. Some 7-8 years they have spent into that one. They don't have any mechanism of getting that degree, even that certificate. And student has taken loan. Once he has been graduated, bank will be saying that you give back those installments, even with interest also. But another side, industries are saying, as Bansalji was saying, that industry is saying that why it has not been groomed according to our requirements, whatever contents you have delivered, it is outdated. The enormous pressure you have created on these children, their cognitive skills, their critical thinking ability, their problem solving abilities are very poor, their communication skills, their soft skills, their team building capabilities, in many, many areas they are blaming. So first of all, the affordability of this education, that is a very serious part in our new education policy, that it should be affordable and the access of this education should be available for everyone. What are your suggestions, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so that the accessibility of the education, it has to be improved, and same time the education should be affordable.
Punya sahab, sabse pehle to aapko bahut bahut dhanyawad. Again calling me on this panel discussion, and that too of a subject which is very close to my heart. वो शब्द आपने चुने हैं ना, एसेस, इक्विटी, क्वालिटी, अफोर्डेबिलिटी एंड अकाउंटेबिलिटी, ये पूरे के पूरे पांचों शब्द एनईपी 20 के आपके फाउंडेशन पिलर्स हैं. एंड फॉर यूनिवर्सिटी लाइक आरजीपीवी विच इज सर्विंग टू स्टूडेंट्स लाइक अबाउट 4 लाख और 5 लाख स्टूडेंट्स एंड अबाउट 500 स्टूडेंट्स आर एफिलिएटिंग टू दिस पर्टिकुलर यूनिवर्सिटी, ये सारे शब्द हमारे बिल्कुल दिल के नजदीक हैं. रीजन इज ये 5 लाख एक्सेसिबिलिटी की बात कर रहा हूँ या एसएस की करने की बात कर रहा हूँ. इसमें एक मैं एग्जांपल कोट करना चाहूंगा. आई वुड लाइक टू कोट वन एग्जांपल. सपोजिंगली आई एम ए मेल स्टूडेंट. आई एम फ्रॉम अपर कास्ट. आई लिव इन एन अनबर्न एरिया एंड माय फैमिली इनकम इज वेरी हाई एंड आई टेकिंग कोचिंग फॉर सिंस लास्ट 4 ईयर्स एट कोटा एंड आई एम गेटिंग ए रैंक ऑफ जेई एट जेई एडवांस 10,000. आई एम ए गर्ल स्टूडेंट. I am residing in a rural area. I am belonging to a lower caste, a low income family or farmer family. And I appear without going through any coaching and get 20,000 JEE rank. Now, how will you compare this equity in terms of equity or in terms of merit also? I am getting admission at RGPV and I am getting admission at some IIT. There is no equity as such. You cannot equate the merit of this girl student with that boy student. And that's the problem of Indian society. This is a typical problem of Indian society. And that is what is we are facing. As far as the funding is concerned, again, you see, one IIT gets in the very same system, one IIT gets it in the tune of rupees 1,000 crore for setting up of this institution, and then 300 to 400 crore rupees further for running up of the institution, and then you allow the institution to charge rupees 2.25 lakh per year as a tuition from the students. University, we are not getting a single price from the state. We are not getting a single price from the central government. Though we are serving 5 lakh students and we are charging only average fee structure in whole university is 45,000 rupees only. There is a paradigm. You can say there is a triangle wherein you talk about assets, quality and cost. And all these three parameters have some interaction actually. If you want to increase access at affordable cost, then you require these kind of universities, affiliating universities, technical universities. But if you want to have the quality technical education, but if you are not supporting the affiliating what we mean by quality education, then the issue comes what we mean by the quality education. In my personal opinion, if a person or girl graduating from my institution shows the same academic attainment which an IIT graduate shows, it means the quality education has been imparted in at RGPV. That's the whole purpose of the quality education. The purpose of the very purpose, what kind of attainment we have to make, if we are fulfilling those attainment, it means the quality parameters have been fulfilled. So while ensuring the access to the quality education, has to be ensured that there is equity in terms of resources, in terms of infrastructure, in terms of financial support. Unless or otherwise, it becomes very difficult to compare one institution with another institution. In India itself, you can see, there are institutions of center which have been termed as institution of excellence. Few institutions have been termed as. Then there is national institution of importance called IITs. Then national institution itself called triple IITs and NITs. Then you have got central funded technical institutions. Then you have got state universities. Then you have got affiliated institutions. Everybody is awarding the very same degree, that bachelor's degree in technology. But yourself at the policy level differentiating between two degrees. It means again there is no equity. This is my personal pain. I hope that this National Education Policy 2020 addresses these issues. Unless otherwise you address these kind of issues while implementing NEP 2020, the basic fundamental on which this policy has been built up, that is access, equity, quality, affordability, and accountability, it is not going to work at all. Already we are seeing that this at present, the whole education arena is being ruled by the persons who are running coaching classes. And it has been already appreciated, it has been already acknowledged. Last 2 or 3 years, sometime it has been already, some efforts have been made how to minimize the role of coaching institutions in getting admissions in institutions of higher learning. that we again we have to ensure, while ensuring this high enrollment ratio, the way we ensure equity while getting admissions in these institutions has to be rationalized. The equity concept has to be brought into the whole admission process. And one way of doing this is, in very clear terms, and I'm very, very clear, you increase the assets. The problem of this quality or equity, the equality, I'm saying equality and equity, there is a difference between equality and equity. The person who is belonging to higher caste says, I'm not seeing the equality because I'm not treating as equal to someone else who is from some other class. Because he doesn't appreciate the concept of equity. That's the reason. Equality is demanded. Equity has to be provided. So this kind of concept is required to be introduced to the whole higher education system. If we are failing in providing the same, we are failing into providing the same. I myself have seen students complaining if there is some problem in past years, in what way I am responsible for the same. Even if there are some societal problems, in what way I am responsible for the same. Despite I am having a higher merit, despite I am having a higher rank, in the name of equity, I have been denied admission in an institution which is termed as institution of excellence or of higher learning or national importance, which is favored in some way or another way by pampering it at national level, by providing it higher resources, providing it higher level of financial resources. And finally, as you may also appreciate, even in classroom, if you say, when you are comparing this quality concept in a classroom, looking after the equity concepts, even in a classroom, you can appreciate the whole concept. Professor Sancheti was suggesting that the teacher, the pace of teaching and the pace of learning is not same. You cannot have the quality in the teaching learning process. The pace of teaching learning should be same. But as you are knowing that students who've been admitted in your class are not having equity in terms of the resources with which they have come up in their classroom, so their learning capability will be of a different pace. And if the teacher is teaching in some pace, it means there will be mismatch between the teaching and the learning, and you cannot expect the quality deliveries. So as far as the SSC is concerned, I'm already astonished, because you also know, as of now, we are having 4 million seats in technical or professional education. And out of those 4 million seats, hardly 50% seats are utilized, and only 25% students are passing out from these students. It means already we have got surplus about 60%, or at least 50% seats are in surplus as of now. So it means that something serious is there. Some serious component is missing in our whole this professional, technical, and even higher education. Even in my Barkatullah University, if departments are lying vacant, they are having capacity of 40, 50, 60, and students are 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5. And in rural areas, the situation is much, much worse, wherein if you have capacity of 100, 200 students, the students are studying at 20, 30. The reason is support system. Either you are not having sufficient infrastructure, or you are not having enough faculty, committed faculty member, accountable faculty member, accountable system, which is delivering the kind of education which is really required for the purpose with which a student is taking admission in such kind of institution. Sir.
I can understand your pain, but my simplest form of question is, enormous infrastructure is available, and yes, we're seeing gross enrollment ratio is only 26-27%. Still 73% students are there who are in the queue or willing to enter into higher education. What is the constraint? There may be hundreds of the constraints, but one of the constraint is that the cost of education which you are having in the country, in most of the advanced countries, more or less higher education for their citizens, it is free. More or less it is free. But in our country, as compared to the family income, the amount of expenditures which is involved into higher education, I'm saying there is no balance. Whatever earning of the families, and in respect to that one, the expenditures which are available on the higher education, there is mismatch. the education is quite costly. One of the reason I'm saying due to that one, students are unable to enter into higher education. Forget about quality education. I'm saying even in education, they are unable to enter into that one, and that's why our GER is less. One solution I can give, and then because you are working on the ground, you may be having many solutions. One solution I can give, suppose now we are having very good confidence in online education. The COVID situation which we are facing since last 6 months, we have gone through the number of means many stages, and particularly one success which we got, that is in this online education. Maybe some 40% success or 50%. I'm not saying absolutely we are doing miracles and everything we have changed, but some confidence building it has. Now through this one, in our technical education, roughly 60% is education component, 40% it is practical, where hands-on part skills are there. And for skilling purposes, our laboratories, our workshops are available. Only for that 40% component, if you are inviting students into the campus for the purpose of imparting that training, remaining 60% component which is there, that is merely educational component, can we provide that educational component through online education? So suppose in a year 1000 hours they are coming into the university, now the requirement will be only for 400 hours, where only for the purpose of skilling part they'll be coming into the university. For 600 hours there is no need to come. So now if stay in the campus is only for 40% time of the total stay, then certainly the cost which you are, or the price of the education which you are charging, it should be less, because very less time they are coming. If price will be lesser, certainly more and more students, more and more children will be dreaming, particularly women education, girls education, more and more girls. If there are two children in the family, one is girl, another one is boy, certainly parents' priority will be that my boy should enter into higher education. Second priority will be given to that girl children. Now, if cost of education has gone down, and in the same course where only one boy was studying, now if two children can study in that education, certainly our enrollment ratio will improve and affordability of this education will come. So this is one of the suggestions which I am saying. Because you are working on the ground, you are having strong rural background, that is one. Second one I am saying, the access is not increasing, in fact, because the educational institutes are not in nearby. In rural areas where 70% population is staying, only 300 universities are there in the country. We are having 640,000 villages in the country. We are having 750 districts. Even in every district, in rural area, that education is not available. 700 universities are available on the big type 1 city or category 1 cities or category 2 city like this one. So there is a mismatch. So with this mismatch and this very high cost of education, how the dreams of this new education policy we will be able to fulfill? Just promise we have done that by 2035. Our gross enrollment ratio will be 50%. But how it will be, in what way, what efforts we should do, so that we can achieve that target? Yes, Sunil ji.
Sir, pehla question jo apne ko answer karna chahiye, that too very honestly, what is the purpose of education, jisko hum answer nahi karte hain usually. If the purpose of the education is to make a citizen for the country, or otherwise the purpose of the education to earn livelihood, isme thoda sa difference aata hai. Supposingly there is a family with a lower income group, उसके दो बच्चे हैं, एक बच्चा हमने किसी तरीके से लोन लेके या कहीं से भी पैसा लेके उसको एक हायर एजुकेशन सिस्टम में डाल दिया, फाइनली पता चला ड्यू टू वेरियस रीजंस वो फाइनली एम्प्लॉयबल नहीं रहा, तो होता क्या है कि जो दूसरा बच्चा है या तीसरा बच्चा है या चौथा बच्चा है, जो पेरेंट्स हैं वो ये सोचते हैं कि देयर इज नो पर्पस, दिस हायर एजुकेशन इज नॉट सर्विंग एनी पर्पस, बिकॉज द पर्पस विथ विच ही हैड एडमिटेड और शी हैड एडमिटेड, शी हैज बीन एडमिटेड इन द सिस्टम, हैज नॉट बीन सर्व्ड. अगर इसकी एक पॉजिटिव साइकिल देखें तो पॉजिटिव साइकिल ये होती है कि अगर पहला बच्चा जो गया वो प्रॉपरली अगर इंप्लॉयड हो जाता है, वो एक अर्निंग मेंबर में कन्वर्ट हो जाता है, तो अपने बाकी बच्चों को या बाकी भाई बहनों को सपोर्ट कर देता है. दैट कन्वर्ट इनटू द पॉजिटिव साइकिल एंड वेयर इन द होल फैमिली गेट्स इनटू द हायर एजुकेशन सिस्टम एंड पूरा उसका सिस्टम, उसका इकोनॉमिक स्टेटस बढ़ जाता है, रुतबा बढ़ जाता है, और जो पर्पज वो जिस पर्पज से उसने हायर एजुकेशन लिया वो पर्पज सर्व हो जाता है उसके लिए. लेकिन व्हाट इज हैपनिंग, जिस चीज को मैं हाईलाइट करना चाहता था फर्स्ट पार्ट में जब मैं डिस्कशन को ले गया आपको, मैं जिस पर्पस आपको हाईलाइट कर रहा था वो पर्पस शायद आप समझ नहीं पाए.
हेलो जी, एक मीटिंग में मैं करूंगा फोन करता हूं.
तो दिस इज डायरेक्ट आप कर रहा था शायद
मैं करूंगा
जिस डायरेक्शन में मैं बात को कह रहा था उसको आप अप्रिशिएट नहीं कर पाए द पर्पस इज विद यू माइट हैव सीन दैट इन अर्ली 20s हायर एजुकेशन में टेक्निकल एजुकेशन के लिए बड़ा यूफोरिया था बहुत ज्यादा बच्चे आते थे इवन इन माई स्टेट 120,000 सीट्स वर देयर और सारी की सारी सीटें फुल हो जाती थी अभी हमारा फर्स्ट राउंड ऑफ काउंसलिंग कंप्लीट हुआ है केवल 9,000 स्टूडेंट ने चॉइस भरी है ओनली 9,000 स्टूडेंट हैव फिल्ड अप देयर चॉइसेस रीजन इज सवाल ये है कि जो हम इन्वेस्टमेंट कर रहे हैं वट एवर इन्वेस्टमेंट वी आर डूइंग इन टर्म्स ऑफ एजुकेशन दैट इन हायर एजुकेशन में इन्वेस्टमेंट वर्ड यूज करूंगा वो वेदर दैट इन्वेस्टमेंट इज वाइज एंड अकाउंटेबल है कि नहीं है वो रीअश्योरिंग है कि नहीं है द काइंड ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट वी आर पुटिंग इट इन टू वो उतने डिलीवरेबल्स उसमें आ रहे हैं कि नहीं आ रहे हैं दैट वी हैव टू एश्योर अगर वो हम एश्योर करने में फेल होंगे तो हम कितनी भी कैपेसिटी क्रिएट कर लेंगे इतनी भी लो कॉस्ट एजुकेशन प्रोवाइड कर देंगे आई एम श्योर नॉट रेज दिस जीआर टू 50% द अल्टीमेटली द पर्पस ऑफ एजुकेशन विथ विच इट हैज बीन इंपार्टेड शुड बी गेट फुलफिल्ड थ्रू दीज इंस्टीट्यूशंस वो ऑब्जेक्टिव्स वो प्रॉपरली डिफाइंड होने चाहिए मेजरेबल होने चाहिए उन मेजर्स पर अगर हमारी एजुकेशन खरी नहीं उतरेगी तो हम बच्चे को हायर एजुकेशन क्लासरूम में नहीं ले पाएंगे वी हैव एनफ कैपेसिटी वेयर इन वी कैन रेज दिस जीआर फ्रॉम 26 to at least 30 or 32%. That much capacity we are already having in our system, built up capacity. But despite that, we are failing to bring the students into our classroom. It means there is something wrong in the whole system where the concept of this whole principle of accountability is missing in the higher education system. We have to bring back this concept of accountability with clearly measurable parameters defining the purpose of education. Unless or otherwise, this whole purpose of education will be lost.
Very good. It means parents are willing, they are spending money, students are willing to learn. But the type of ambience, type of environment which was supposed to be given by our university, we have failed. It means sole concentration on the type of environment, the type of facility, the type of learning students are having, that it has to be improved. It should be for the betterment of society. The clearly outcomes, it has to be measurable outcomes, it has to be, and all those outcomes, friends should be able to achieve those outcomes, it has to be. So accountability is a issue, and who is accountable? Now, first of all, who is sufferer? Students are sufferer, parents are sufferer, industries are sufferer, everyone is sufferer, except we teachers, we are not sufferer. It means because we are unable to give that type of environment which expectations society having. Now everyone is sufferer. It means accountability, it has not been fixed.
Yes.
The time and money which friends have spent, what exactly values they are getting in lieu of that one. So value of that time, value of the money which they have spent, it has to be. Professor Ranjan Bose from IIT Delhi. Sir, are you available?
Yes.
Able to listen to us?
Sir, he's not there.
No. Sanjay ji, in your absence, very, very serious issue we have discussed, and that is accountability now. Use money parents are paying to us, to the institutes, they are paying. In time, when we are asking, this is the fee structure, you please pay. They are paying. But as Professor Sunil is saying, the expected learning outcomes we are unable to deliver. If we won't be giving that expected learning outcomes, our gross enrollment ratio can't increase. It will be increasing only if the certain parameters of the education which we are having, the learning outcomes, it should match for the betterment of the society, for the community, for the whole globe, and even development of individual. That it has to be. What you will suggest for that one? How, first of all, those goals, the learning outcomes, it has to be decided, and it will be changing time and again, it will be changing. So how that vibrant mechanism, it has to be created so that learning outcomes exactly according to the society, it has to match, and that type of environment inside to our university, we should be able to provide. And what should be the role of regulator? Just I'm giving the example of Hong Kong. In Hong Kong, since 1997 to 2015, even today, there is no regulator, particularly for school education, there is no regulator. And there is two sites in the education. In fact, one is effect of China, where conventional education system they were having, the impact of UK, where very advanced mechanism of education it is having without any regulator. Just they are fixing the accountability of the institute. Every institute is responsible towards the government. Whatever outcomes government is saying, they are supposed to give, and they need to prove that we people are something different and we are doing as per the whims of the government. Now, in our education system, can we bring the type of model which Hong Kong is having, and many of the countries are following that model now. They are trying to follow that model. What are your suggestions?
Okay, Punia sir, I'm sorry I missed a certain set of discussions, and I'm sure must have been very enchanting and interesting. The point which you have kind of raised right now seems to be very complex. I would put it to be more of societal nature. What examples you gave for education space are equally true for other common spaces, whether it is the cleanliness in the living arenas where we are there, or maybe a traffic sense. So we find that in our case, without someone overseeing us, we do not do what we are required to do. And therefore, that mindset change has to come. We probably operated with a very, very different mindset, where possibly you can say a regulation or danda or something like that became important. And maybe to some extent, the word regulation was always taken like that, that someone is going to control us. I also know that when I was a new faculty in 1984, everything was being done by outside persons, setting up the syllabus, setting up the scheme, question papers, evaluation, result. My duty was not to do anything except but to teach in the classroom. Now the roles have changed, but I have not been trained for that. By myself, I have not trained myself, or my institutions have not trained, or anyone else possibly. Or even if the training has been done, I think our attitude towards those changes has been very, very poor, that we have not been receptive to that. And that is possibly the reason why such challenges are there. I would possibly say that many, many times I have said, take it in the lighter vein only. When we are at home, we are worried about the office, and when we are worried, when at office, we are worried about home. We are not focused enough to what we are supposed to do and how we are supposed to do. If I am in my institution, I think I should make it a mandate for myself, come what may. That is the time I will devote fully, whether it's my self-development, institutional development, my student development, or something new. With that mandate, if we do, all those changes will possibly start happening, and you will start thinking of new policies. And for that, obviously, I should be empowered. And therefore, you have this new regulatory thing called light but tight. I think I'm pretty happy with that. Light in the sense that you are giving the freedom. Tight is that when you make a mistake, and especially an intentional mistake, I think you should be punished adequately. And with that, I'm sure the correction will set in. I'm for one who has used my powers to do what I think was correct, whether it's correcting myself or my students or my this thing. And therefore, we see that what is the outcome of that. I think that is a philosophy we need to follow. When it comes to the teaching, learning, and objectives, the unfortunate part is all the stakeholders are possibly at mistake. Teachers certainly are. But unfortunately, teacher sometimes is not adequately equipped in their conditions for that. And therefore, I'll give them a slight advantage, or you can say slight benefit of doubt. A student who's aspiring to come to an engineering institution, for an example, is not asking us, what is he going to learn? Who is your best teacher? What is the best thing I can learn here and do? The only thing which are being asked, whether it's in a government or a private institution, how about the placement? How about the package? These are the kind of things which are the driving force. And therefore, many of us are pushed into something which is not necessarily education driven, but it is more driven by something which is a fancy stuff. I think that is a little bit of challenge. But once again, I'm telling you that I'm very, very positive about that. Inclusion or intrusion of technology is an answer for every ill, as far as I'm concerned in my life. If I'm having ill health, technology helps me. If I want to get connected with you, wherever you may be in the world, technology is a help. and so many other things in our life. Education was a slow moving as far as technology thing was concerned, for whatever reasons, maybe cost, maybe adoption, maybe attitude, maybe acceptance. Even now the acceptance is a challenge. I was attending the other one conference. A lot of students will tend to ask, when are we going offline? So they are not necessarily happy with the technology. But let's accept one fact. If there is a shortage of teacher, technology is the answer. If there is a poor quality, technology is the answer. If you want to measure the outcomes and trace the, do the tracer studies, who's doing what, technology is an answer. And therefore, technology has to be viewed as an assistant to us and has to be included into everything. Fortunately, NETF has been created. Fortunately, even labs like virtual labs have been set in NEP 2020. I think they are going to be the ones which are going to be there. Once again, outcome should be measured with my expectation. I have come in with an expectation that this is what I will read, study, achieve, and whatever. It is not with institutional objective. Institution gives a framework, but a student has to say, my objective is to become an IAS after this, or become a scientist after this, an academician, or do an entrepreneurship, or do a private job. I think that should be met as an outcome, even though they all might be sitting in one class. And therefore, I would say that we have to, in education system, remove those what we call silos. I'm sure you've been discussing these points time and again for the last few days, and these are very, very important. And once I know that what is my life, I may be a person interested in music, but if I know a little bit of electronics, maybe I can help my music, because it has all gone electronic in terms of generation, storage, reproduction, distribution, everything. It can help. And therefore, the outcomes can vary. A single teacher possibly will find it difficult in a given class of 60 or 100, whatever, to deliver the standard outcomes. Let the outcomes be tailorable. Let this be measured almost every day. Once again, the technology can measure every day. Anonymously, you can send to a teacher, this was the best thing you've done today, and this is not the best thing you've done today. And the teacher can come tomorrow in the next class and deliver that again. And therefore, the quality will improve. The outcomes will also improve. And the energy or the synergy will also improve between the system. That's what I had to say.
Very good. So one of the reason you are saying use silos are available inside the campus, even forget about inside the campus, I'm saying between school education and higher education, there is a great silos. We have never entered into our schools. In fact, we are saying that students are entering into our institutes. They are dreaming for higher packages, even they don't know what expectations or what outcomes after this 4 years degree they like to have, what responsibility they like to have, because we don't have any connect. Yeah. Since we have some mechanism of connecting our higher education institutes with school education, and our campuses are emptied, in fact, our infrastructure is unutilized because we are unable to attract those school-going students into our technical institutes or higher education institutes. So some mechanism, if we can devise, at least for one professor every day, if half an hour, if he can be connected, now technology, it is well-proved technology, can we connect our professors with school-going students also, that if you are entering into this type of education, you will be doing these miracles in your career. So dreams will be there, and certainly for them, entering into these institutes will be much easier. One part is this one. Second one, again, Sunilji, I'm saying, probably we were unable to deliver according to the expectation of the society, and their role of teacher is very, very important. Now in new education policy, there is a concept of strong teaching pedagogical skills of the teachers. There will be 4 years BEd program, Bachelor of Education. In higher education now, someone is doing M.Tech today, tomorrow we are saying enter into the class, handle 60 students, quality education you'll have to provide, and those graduates will be able to compete at global level. First of all, the role of the teacher, in what way the contents it has to be delivered, how assessment of strengths it has to be done. No formal education, no formal training was given to our teachers. Now we should be thankful to this new education policy. There is a strong component of this teacher's education. And even there is a mechanism of awarding teachers also. Awarding means even in during those BEd programs, if some colleges, some universities are doing good job, they'll be awarded also. We'll be having universities at every district, and in every district, in every university, there has to be a BEd program, 4 years BEd program. So certainly the quality of teachers will be better, and hopefully the expectations which parents are having from us will be able to prove. Rakesh Sharma ji, your ideas about the dreams which friends are having, parents are having, one is quality teachers if you are having, quality curriculum if you are having, quality delivery if it is having, and if you are doing justice for assessing these strengths, what else it has to be done so that the dreams which friends are having, we should be able to fulfill. Again, some 40,000 seats, some 9,000 students have applied. That is application, that is not the final registration, that is not final enrollment. That may be 5,000. So again, some 30,000-40,000, if you are able to attract 5,000 students, how this system will work, how the dream of this very high growth and enrollment will be able to achieve.
So if you permit me, in fact, this question also relates to one question you were raising repeatedly, and I was very keenly listening to honorable panelists about how to achieve the targets of gross enrollment ratio. So this target of gross enrollment ratio at 50% in the year 2030, it is a very paradoxical situation. The same policy advocates quality. The same policy is laying a focus on achieving the gross enrollment ratio of 50% in next 5-7 years. It is paradoxical because how can
next 15 years, 2030, 15 years.
So it is paradoxical because your gross enrollment ratio, if the strategy adopted is it does not enforce the quality, probably the one important pillar of, as was the right word used by Professor Guptaji, it will be shattered, because it is one important pillar is quality. Unless we first discuss the building, the capacity. Do you know, sir, how many, at the same time we are saying that the gross enrollment ratio in school education has to go to 100%. It will directly affect the number of teachers you will require or number of seats that will be created or that will have to be created to achieve 50% gross enrollment ratio in the higher sector. It will also contribute to that. Where are the teachers is one big question, and you in fact raised a question of availability of teachers and teacher education. It is an issue which must be pondered over, sir. Unless we address these basic issues of availability of quality teachers, capacity building of quality teachers, building the financial capability of the job of the institutions, owners, etc., etc., probably even if we are able to achieve it, the very important facet of the quality, the requirement of quality will be disturbed, will not be achieved. Number two, sir, you expressed great hopes in online mode of learning. Very true, sir. I fully appreciate. In fact, this corona pandemic has given us an opportunity or compelled us to try that. Sir, we conducted a survey of 920 students, and out of 920, 46% informed that they have a problem of quality connectivity. We also wanted to know from them which service provider they are using, and it included every, right from Vodafone to Airtel to every, and including broadband connectivity. There was concerns about availability of power. We were very shaky agreeing to those findings. Till the time we got access to a report of QSI Gaze, they have also done an identical study. The report is already available on QSI Gaze website, where they are saying that more than 49 to 53% students, they are complaining of non-availability of proper connectivity and proper power. So this, again, rather, sir, we inferred, we had constituted a group, and the group inferred that this online education is, again, it is creating a problem for very another important pillar of national education policy, that is equity and access. Those who are poor, you are raising an issue of those who come from rural areas. I also come from that area. Students from rural areas, from the poverty-stricken society, they are definitely disadvantaged. They have been discriminated by. I am not condemning or I am not criticizing the online mode of education. I am saying how it is affecting the equity and the equity and the access. These are the important things. So as on date, even online education is probably not a ready solution to address the issue of achieving the gross enrollment ratio as the issue of quality. We have to invest a lot on time, on concern, on money to build the capacity to put in to achieve that target, as also to create technological infrastructure, as Professor Sancheteji is repeatedly saying that technology is the solution. That is one thing, sir. But sir, in fact, I perceived this panel discussion when I saw the mail, that as if council is trying to sort of seek our inputs about how it can help in this scenario in implementing the national education policy. Probably if I have jotted some points, I'll take note 3-4 minutes. there will be answers to a couple of questions that have been raised by you, sir. Sir, we have to appreciate that the private sector has contributed to maybe more than 80-85% of technical education expenses. Let us see these islands of excellence, IIT and NITs. There can be endless discussions on whether they have contributed or whether they have discriminated. All those things are apart. It is not a subject matter of this discussion. But the point is 90% seats are there because private sector came. Today, sir, we all know, especially the council knows, you have done wonderful work, sir, Professor. I think Professor Bansal appreciated in your absence the role, the regulator and facilitator roles you have acquired. I fully endorse what he is saying. But sir, the point is now council has another very important challenge to handle. Today, maybe more than 1,000 institutions I know in NCR, at least which area I keep visiting quite often, they are lying closed because students are not there. They are lying closed physically as also lying closed because the capacity utilization is only 20%. That also creates a problem of access, sir, which is another important issue we are discussing, because all these institutions which have been closed or which are facing closure or which are compelled to impart a very poor quality of education because their financials are not permitting, they are located in rural areas. That is another way how my rural students are being discriminated and the issue of equity is being affected, sir. So how can council now work out a revival strategy? How it can work out a strategy to revive these institutions is very important, sir. I can offer many, but a couple of things are, if Professor Sancheti, if the SRM University decides to mentor few of them or adopt few of them, but the council will have to come out with a scheme. Council will have to come out with, maybe those institutions are struggling in my area and there are the, probably my university enjoys an identical sort of reputation. So if I can accept the responsibility of through a structured regulatory mechanism, which is put in place by council, adopting those institutions, giving them my name, my brand, ensuring them that they fill up those seats, I also guide their academics, I mentor their academics, I mentor their personality development programs, and right up to the level of getting them placed, probably it can be one way of revival. How financials work out, all those things are different, but this unutilized capacity, isse sir jo nuksan hua hai ye hua ki private sector sir aapka bhag jayega. Jin logon ne 20-20 crore rupaye lagaye the, jab wo itna loss utha gaye, wo bhag jayega sir. Gross enrollment ratio jab aapko badhana hoga to infrastructure bhi aapko chahiye. आप मुझे कहेंगे मैं तो पहले ही दूध का जला हुआ हूं, मैं तो पहले ही 20 करोड़ रुपए लॉस कर चुका हूं, आपको इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर की अवेलेबिलिटी में दिक्कत आएगी. एक तो सर आप देखिए अगर आपको लगता है ये संभव है. देन सर आज सर इस ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन में सर द प्रॉब्लम दैट हैज कम इज काउंसिल वेरी राइटली फोकस्ड ए मैंडेटरी इंटर्नशिप. टूडे आई एम रियली स्ट्रगलिंग टू फाइंड इंटर्नशिप्स एंड दिस हैंड्स ऑन एक्सपीरियंस हैज बीन वेरी राइटली एम्फेसाइज्ड एंड असर्टेड बाय regulatory bodies as also by the industry. Can council help revival of these institutions which are facing another challenge because the students are not getting industry internships? Sir, another problem which has arisen because of this online learning is this peer learning, student-centering learning, and this learning, project-based learning, and the value-based learning, all those things have become a serious challenge, sir. This holistic grooming of students, grooming of students is being tested by this online learning. Senior academicians, whom I respect a lot because they are the one who are behind all the growth of this education, higher and technical education, they have coined a new phrase, new normal. Sir, I feel it is, at the moment, it is a new abnormal, which has to be very concerted efforts have to be there over next 1 year or 2 years to convert this new abnormal into a new normal, sir. Another thing, sir, today, because now it is a question of equity, since you have raised the question of equity, that I am raising this, otherwise may not be directly related. Maybe more than 1 lakh students, they have dropped out because they are not able to deposit fees. Again, they are girls, or they are rural students, or they are poor students. The question is there, at least in my university, I know, we have tried to help them in every possible way, monthly installments, the waiving of fees, many things have been done, but still, I know today 1 lakh students. So now there is a provision of academic, some credit, some where I can keep my credits in bank. Sir, it is something which may sound probably at the moment, it may sound illogical, but can sir council consider that you conduct online classes, you have wonderful best teachers available in the country. You have an access to everybody who who is known to be a good teacher in the country. Can we have a structured online classes where I attend since I have dropped out? Then you get me examined through an examining body, maybe National Board of Examination, something. And then I earn some credits. Next year, when I'm my position is comfortable, when I'm in a position to, I go to my university, ki dekhiye sahab, ye maine credits earn kiye the, second year mein ye hain, aap inko lijiye, now I want to continue my studies. Maybe millions of students, if not millions, at least few lakh, they are today dropped out, sir. Having said that, sir, और कई इश्यूज हो सकते हैं आप सर वर्चुअल लैब्स के माध्यम से सर देखिए जो ये बातें हैं ना जी ये छोटे इंस्टीट्यूशंस को प्रॉब्लम है सर छोटे इंस्टीट्यूशंस के पास ऑनलाइन टेस्टिंग के प्लेटफॉर्म्स नहीं है मैंने तो सर ओवरनाइट क्रिएट कर लिया आई वाज इन ए पोजीशन टू स्पेंड मे बी एसआरएम माइट हैव स्पेंट लिटिल मोर एंड यूपीएस हैज स्पेंट थ्री टाइम्स मोर देन व्हाट आई हैव स्पेंट बिकॉज वी वर कैपेबल ऑफ स्पेंडिंग बट नॉर्मल इंस्टीट्यूशंस द इंस्टीट्यूशंस एफिलिएटेड टू एफिलिएटिंग यूनिवर्सिटीज टुडे आई हैव नॉट बीन एबल टू कंडक्ट एग्जामिनेशंस और वेरी पुअर क्वालिटी ऑफ एग्जामिनेशंस दैट इज आल्सो एन इशू कैन यू सर हेल्प देम इन डेवलपिंग वर्चुअल लैब्स कंडक्टिंग सच क्लासेस एंड कैन यू हेल्प देम इन डेवलपिंग सम कॉमन ई कंटेंट्स बेस्ड ऑन योर मॉडल करिकुलम व्हिच my students can access today council which I am sharing it with you sir because having known professor Shai Shukude sir you and other advisors I have all the hope I have all the confidence I have served this organization sir I have seen it changing colors I have seen it changing contours so today I have great hope that you can do it sir now coming to what you were saying because you told that why students why parents are dropping out or so the question in fact is a very serious question when parents are not availing even the available infrastructure how I will increase the gross enrollment ratio how I can seamlessly integrate my school higher education and technical education these are very serious issues sir for example sir I'll again quote from a system where I worked in Himachal sir aap dhyan se meri baat ko mujhe bada ajeeb lagta tha college mein jaate the na punia sir to college bachchon ko kuch nahi aata angrezi are sir ye 12th mein kuch padha ke hi nahi bhejte आप 12th में जाए सर अरे सर 10th में कुछ कराते ही नहीं है ये तो इनको एबीसी भी नहीं सिखाते हैं उसी 10th के स्कूल के अंदर एक 8th का स्कूल है आप केवल ग्राउंड को पार करके उधर जाए जो मिडिल स्कूल है वो उस पर रिस्पॉन्स है और वो कह रहा है कि सर प्राइमरी स्कूल कुछ नहीं कराता ये सर जो बक ऑफ पासिंग ऑफ रिस्पॉन्स जब तक सर आपका स्कूल एजुकेशन स्ट्रेंथन नहीं होगा ग्रॉस एनरोलमेंट रेशियो केवल एक मैकेनिकल फिगर रह जाएगी एक मैथमेटिकल फिगर अगर हम अचीव भी कर लेंगे तो क्वालिटी एक बहुत सीरियस इशू हो जाएगा सर उसमें सर आज के दिन सर 1190 कॉलेज तो हिमाचल जैसी छोटी सिटी में थे स्कूल जिनमें 3 बच्चे थे उस इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर को कैसे हम लिवरेज कर सकते हैं टेक्नोलॉजी के माध्यम से दैट इज दीज आर द अपॉर्चुनिटीज अवेलेबल आपने सर अकाउंटेबिलिटी की बात की इनफैक्ट सर जो आप एग्जाम्पल दे रहे हैं ये अकाउंटेबिलिटी का एक उदाहरण है If parents have stopped sending teachers, students, their wards to nearby institutions, parents have written their annual confidential report. Parents ने उनकी accountability already fix कर दिया और हम क्या accountability fix करेंगे सर उनकी parents ने उन्हें बच्चे भेजने बंद कर दिए colleges को ताला लग गया accountability is already fixed. But sir, can in such a huge democracy with millions of youth, where we have a great demographic edge. Today I have a great demographic edge, which is the most important potential. I have to be the world power in next 5 to 10 years. उसके अंदर क्या मैं islands of excellence के base पे survive कर सकता हूँ? क्या SRM, VIT, MIT, क्या यही 4-5 institutions या 10 institutions या 100 institutions? क्या ये इन issues को address कर सकते हैं? अगर सर ये कोशिश की जाएगी, तो संभव नहीं हो पाएगा सर. हमें काउंसिल के सर आपके माध्यम से कैसे आप इस क्वालिटी और इक्विटी और इन एक्सेस और इन इश्यूज को आप हर कॉलेज में ले जा सकते हैं कैसे आप उनके रिवाइवल की एक स्ट्रेटजी वर्क सर आपके पास हालांकि ये लाइटर वेन में नहीं है पर मैं लाइटर वेन में कह रहा हूँ मैं जानता हूँ आपके पास सर आपके पास भी 500-700 हजार करोड़ रुपए है सर इनके रिवाइवल के लिए सॉफ्ट टर्म लोन दीजिए ना इनको बंद पड़े हैं गिव देम सॉफ्ट टर्म लोन सर I am not saying give them grants, give them softer norms and then monitor their progress ki kar kya rahe hain wo and let us see if we can have a 5-year revival strategy lakhon seat meri create ho jayenge jo mere ko gross enrollment ratio mein aur jo meri quality ko address karenge abhi sir mujhe itna hi kehna hai unless ki aap iske ilawa mere se kuch janna chahe mujhe itna hi is sir thank you
very very good rakesh ji lot of interest you have created lot of issues you have raised and many solutions you have given it's wonderful honorable chairman sir is also visible I'll be requesting chairman sir that issue which you are discussing today it was related to equity access affordability quality and accountability and the experts who are connected chairman sir Are you able to listen, sir?
I was on a telephone call, so
yes,
but I was listening to the later part right from Professor Sunil Gupta, Professor Sancheti, Professor Rakesh Sharma. I didn't listen to Professor Bansal ji, but I'm seeing him here on the platform. But some of the issues which were raised by these people are absolutely relevant, and I would like to reiterate some of the things in terms of our own clarity is required. You know, when the policy is talking about increasing the gross enrollment ratio, certainly there are issues which we need to address. So one of the things is using as much as possible online education, and not necessarily create the brick and mortar infrastructure, which we have been doing it all the time. Secondly, we have been insisting on very large areas for the universities and colleges, which is not required, because in foreign countries, especially in some of the top universities in the US, there are huge universities and there are very small universities. I think quality of education is not dependent on the quantum of buildings and the spaces that are there and all that. And therefore, I think some relaxation in the norms in terms of that is also required, whereby even if some additional brick and mortar infrastructure is required, can be created at a reasonable cost. But more importantly, I think we have come to stay with the online education. We had some serious doubts in the past about the efficacy of that. We have seen it through the faculty development programs. We have done several workshops in this pandemic in the last 5 months, and each one of them is a roaring success. And that shows that there is a possibility. Professor Rakesh ji mentioned that some of the private universities with deep pockets were in a position to create or buy whatever systems whereby they were able to continue both online education as well as examination was conducted. But let me assure you that there are platforms of all variety in India, and huge number of them have come, you know, because of the startup ecosystem culture which is there, and many of them are absolutely at reasonable cost. It is almost much less than even your normal pen and paper examination which you are conducting, much less than that. And therefore, please do not have that worry. You don't have to buy the most expensive one. One can always buy a reasonably cost and also equally which has the proctoring capability in terms of the camera being taking care of whether you are writing or whether you are copying or whether what you are doing is also monitored there. I think therefore using technology for all this will certainly enable us to reach 50% gross enrollment ratio as envisaged, and we should not have any worries about that. And at the same time, you talked about what is laboratory classes and all that equipment, but I think virtual labs have also come to stay. And many experiments which otherwise required huge infrastructural requirement in terms of equipment buying is no more required. I'm not saying that there should be no laboratory in the colleges. There must be laboratories in the colleges, but you need not buy, you know, all variety of equipment in your institution. There are two possibilities. One, in the neighborhood with another college, you can share part of the, you know, share the facilities. If there are 5 colleges in the Chennai area or in Bangalore or in Pune or somewhere, why can't they even join together? You know, I buy 5 equipment. See, bare minimum equipment, of course, everyone should have. But some additional equipment which will really get taste of experiments, actually, why can't they share amongst themselves? And then why can't they use the virtual labs for doing all this? I think there are multiple opportunities which are available, which we have never explored. One of the reasons is we always worked in silos. Punya ji was telling, and even Sancheti was telling, that our famous thing is within the, forget about the institution, and between institution is a far-fetched thing, but within institution, forget it, even within the department, 2 faculty members, if they have got a project from some funding agency, only that faculty's students are allowed to operate that where the money has come. The others are not allowed. Then to that extent, we build walls. And when Berlin Wall can be broken, I think these walls need to be immediately broken. I think if you do that and we keep on going ahead with collaboration within the department, within the institution, multiple institutions, I think all of this is not a dream, but it is a reality which can certainly happen. But at the same time, Punya ji was all the time talking about reduction of fees. in the whole process of doing all this, wherever we are able to save money, certainly that benefit should be transferred to the student. I'm with him in, on that respect. But at the same time, where we cannot cut corners and the expenditure is essential, I think just because we have to give cheaper education, we probably will not be able to do. And that is what has happened in many of the states, with the state fee regulatory committees restricting the quantum of fees being charged allowed. And they cannot pay the salaries of the faculty. And if they can't pay the faculty salaries, how can you get good faculty? And who will be motivated to teach? And therefore, there is a fine balance which is required between the fee being charged. And I'm sure in our own system, many people are willing to pay a high fee, provided they get a corresponding commensurate quality of education. And there are umpteen examples. I will not name the institutions, but some of the best management institutions and engineering colleges charge a very hefty fee, but there is a line, and people say that, please give us admission in that institution. But on the other side, government also has a responsibility in terms of taking care of people who even cannot afford that, one-tenth of that. And therefore, there are scholarships, there are easy loan facilitation, which is required to be done by the government. I think those are the other related areas. But I think return on investment is what people look at. And that's why when parents were able to send children to engineering colleges or management schools, and at the end of the program, they were getting a reasonably good package where whatever money was spent by the parents or taking loan can be returned in about 4 to 5 years. No one bothers about it. But if you don't get a reasonable job and you cannot even feed your own family after the graduation, where is the possibility of returning the loan? And therefore, I think that is where we came into the cycle, and we have to come out of that. And that's why the entire process of light but tight regulation, which is very important, and giving a lot of freedom to the institutions to be what we call a Lakshman Rekha. So each one has to draw their own Lakshman Rekhas. I think rather than regulatory body drawing some Rekha, khud usko banana jyada jaruri hai, so that you are transparent, you are what is said is not only access, equity, quality. We are talking about two other pillars, is affordability and accountability. And the accountability should be based on self-disclosure. And if the disclosure is not correct, fake disclosure, like fake faculty, fake equipment, fake laboratories being available, and we receive a complaint as a regulatory body, whether this body or the new body which is going to be created, I think very, very strong penal actions are desired. And once such one or two institutions get strong action, I think others will learn lessons from that. We all know the story of Satyam. Now in the corporate world, we don't get any more new Satyams. So I think that is what should happen in the academic institutions as well. And I'm sure in the process of this national new education policy, the deliberations and the wisdom that all of you have shared, we will try to create a report which is holistic, which is taking care of both sides. See, I think we are a country of a very complex nature, too much diversity. There are people who can afford education in US. Forget about undergraduate education. For even school, someone can afford to send a child abroad. But there are others, even for postgraduate education, where limited fee waiver is available. People will have to take huge loan, and that is not possible many times because you have to give collateral something. And therefore, there are both varieties. So a middle path is to be followed by us. And some of the students who are aspiring, who are brilliant, they must get an opportunity. This policy talks about both sides. There is also a one of the statements which say that gifted children also should be taken care of. Otherwise, our normal course is for the lowest common denominator. So the syllabus is made for those people who somehow will be able to pass. Similarly, everything which is done is based on minimum things required. I think minimum should be the minimum. That minimum itself should be raised continuously year after year. For example, we are continuously increasing the internet bandwidth required by institutions. Because unless that is there, you have Wi-Fi connectivity on the campus. How do you use MOOCs? How do you use the Swayam platform and various other resources which are available freely? I think some of these issues are required to be increased, whereas we need to be softer on other activities like reduce the the quantum of amount required, because sharing can be allowed, the same building can be used to, you know, two times, three times, whatever. You can have a shared library, shared cycle stand, canteen. I think wherever it is possible to really share, we must share. And where it is not possible to share, we should be very strong on that. I think that is where we need to lead to. And in the process, we will get both access, equity, quality, as well as affordability and excellence, along with the accountability, which is very important, because in this panel, except Professor Guptaji, all others, maybe they had a stint in the government, but right now they're all representing a financial sector, which is a private sector. And that's why it was overemphasis was on the other side. But nevertheless, I think the balance is required on both sides. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Sanchit wants to reply to something which I have narrated, so I think he should get an opportunity. I can again debate with him actually on something.
I don't want to respond to any of the points you have said in general. I just want to support what I was saying because they were coming in the context. And there is a big debate on what we call digital divide. And I don't necessarily agree with that. I call it as digital provide. I give you the examples of banking. I've seen banking as a child or when I was growing up in my job, and I've seen the change now. Sitting right now, I can do wonderful things. See the power of mobile, and we are all connected, and how cheap it is effectively, either the device or the connectivity. Now see the power of energy, the solar energy. I'm again saying tech or electronic or whatever, IT, whatever you may call it. It's going to 3 rupees a unit or 4 rupees a unit typically, which was anyway growing linearly, continuously. See the power of that now in automobiles. Energy has already gone cheap and the vehicle will become electrical vehicle. The transportation will become cheap. Please, for God's sake, let's all understand that technology, once sets in properly, it mitigates the cost. It reduces the cost. Can you be in your home today without a fridge or an AC or a cooker or a gas? I think these are the contributions of technology. Can you name one such thing in education which has come from technology, without which we cannot live? There is none. So fortunately, it's making an entry. Let's accept it wholeheartedly, and it will cut down the cost. It will improve the quality. It will improve the access. It will do anything which is required. As I said in the beginning, technology can be a slave, can be a donkey. Technology will behave with reliability, unlike us who may change the stance from time to time. So that's the technology one, because there was a point which Rakeshji was making mention about that technology is not reaching. But let's understand, steam engine probably first came in UK and then spread all over the world. It takes time. Now that the speed has gone fast, the technology's dissipation into various parts of world or ecosystem is becoming faster. I'm sure today's villager will not be able to live without a mobile. That is the adoption and acceptability of technology. And very soon they'll be doing it for the education. Just 2-3 small points without explanation, Puniaji. One, you are saying school education, connect with the school. I think we are doing a mistake that we are not going to schools. We should do it like industries come to us. We should also go to schools. And one good example there would be make it mandatory or at least make it useful to do an open day for the schools and for the public. What this institution is doing, the students should know, prospective students should know. IITs do, sometimes IISc do, but most of the institutions don't do it. Let's possibly try to do it. You also had a one point on the outcome-based something. I would be very fancied by one outcome that once I graduate, I don't deal with this defined, described kind of a problems. I don't have to give the answer sheet and all that. I have to deal with the problem which my boss gives me and tells me that after a week you give an answer. And that's my open book examination. I can consult my friends, I can consult books, I can consult internet. And therefore, prepare our students and our system for a full open book kind of a thing. I'm telling you, students are scared of open book right now. They know that they would not succeed. They'll only keep flipping the pages once they're trying to answer. So these are some of the things which are there. And the last point you were asking, or maybe someone was suggesting, maybe Rakeshji himself, SRM is part of what we call this Paramarsh or Margdarshak scheme, or maybe many such schemes. I'm one who have very strongly said, when I was in the NIT system that we were parentless child. हम लोग अनाथ थे, हमारा कोई माँ बाप नहीं था, हमें 10 यूनिवर्सिटीज में अलग अलग टाइम पे अलग अलग दे दिया गया डिग्री देने के लिए, तो हमारा सिस्टम सारा मिक्स हो गया. Whereas IITs, see that IITs were nurtured by US or UK or some institutions from those countries, and they could really do well in relative terms. And that is the power of mentoring. We at SRM are ready. I'm sure many institutions are ready, which are most of you are ready. Let us make a scheme and let's, like we in UBA, Unnat Bharat Abhiyan, we are mentoring villages and we are doing something for them. Let's mentor some 5 institutions in neighborhood. But when we went into Paramarsh and Margdarsh, and then we had to give the get the consent from 10 institutions, we had hard time. Institutions were thinking that we are trying to overpower them, empower them, we'll do something to them. I think if the scheme is made more vibrant, more open, more understandable, it will probably work, and good institutions, big institutions will certainly contribute. That's a response, sir. Sir, with this, I have nothing to counter. I'm fully with the new education policy and some of the views and the practices which are being developed and followed here to get the good outcomes out of that. Thank you.
See, there was a question here in the chat box about AICT should support provide learning management system. For your information, we have already sent an email to all the institutions that Bodhi Tree from IIT Bombay is available free of cost. It's a learning management system. Individually, you can either use the cloud services of IIT Bombay itself or on your own servers or your own wherever cloud, and then make use of it. Similarly, Ample or AView of Amruta is also available. It's also free of cost. I think you'll have to look at what are the possible things which are available where, and then start looking at them and then start using them. You don't have to spend money on many of the things. Lot of open source software is available, and some of the things which IIT Bombay Professor Kannan Modgulya all the time keeps on advocating in terms of open source and open systems, and many competitions are held for that, including instead of MATLAB there is a Scilab which has so many modules, and recently our students created 10 new modules for the Scilab. Otherwise, which is not there in the Scilab, but it was there in MATLAB. I think these are the opportunities times, and we must not lose them. Seize the opportunities.
May you also have before we close.
It was very, very special, sir, and one very prominent suggestion which is coming, that is sharing of the resources. Many, many good equipments, good faculty members we are having in the country. If those resources can be shared, again, sir, I'm coming on the same point. If sharing of the research resources can become effective, even affordability of this education, cost of the education can come down, because many of the resources are unutilized. And that's why extra payment it has to be made. And that is being one of the reason for very high cost in the education. Rakesh Sharma ji, your worry was that quality multiplied by quantity remains constant. You said once quantity will increase, quality will go down. It should not be. Our target, it has to be quantity also should go and quality also should go up. So multiplication of quality and quantity, it should go up always. Only serious concern is our railways are overcrowded, our hospitals are overcrowded, our platforms are overcrowded, our transport system is overcrowded. Only problem is our university seems empty. Our target is more and more students should take benefit of this one. Quality education is dream, but at least education it has to be. They should be able to explain, in fact, what they are. That much education, if we can provide to general human being, I think it will be a wonderful contribution. Many of the teachers are connected now, sir. Honorable Chairman, sir, is also here. They may be having many, many questions in their mind. Some of the questions we'll be taking, and our experts, Honorable Chairman, sir, will be replying at least some of the queries which are being raised by the participants.
Punia ji, very interestingly, today there was a SAARC summit of education ministers on COVID crisis and how each nation has overcome the problem. And on behalf of India, I had to speak there, and I had that opportunity. When I spoke, at the end of that, at least out of all other nations, they just appreciate, but Malay and Afghanistan, they said they already used many of the things of AICT and MHRD, then that is SPIRE, etc. And all the teacher training program, Nepal and all these three countries, they said, this is a very exciting thing that teacher certification program started by AICT is so important. And we would like to make use of that. I think that gives credit to Puniaji. You have done such a great work. So thank you for all the support that has been there from all along.
मैं इस चिंता में आपको फोन कर रहा था सर कि आप शायद भूल नहीं गए हो टीचर्स ट्रेनिंग वाला, लेकिन आपने कहा पहले से मैंने नोट किया, there is no need to worry, all dimensions, all work which you are doing in AICT, everything is written. Even in on paper, if it is paper is not there, मेरे दिमाग में सारा लिखा हुआ है कि आप चिंता मत करो और सारे समुदाय में उसी तरह से मैं जा रहा हूँ. It's good, sir. Now, with your kind permission, sir, some of the questions we'll be taking from the participants.
Sir, though not much, not number of queries have come. Mostly the queries are
appreciation. Lot of appreciation is coming.
It's
the way our experts have delivered.
Yes.
Lot of word of appreciation is coming.
It is actually more or less an appreciation only of our activities which has happened, and especially the way the conduct has gone ahead today, with every concern being addressed. However, two three issues, just for a purpose of clarification, somebody wants to know that even though this particular new education policy is 2020, can it be for the purposes of making those students who left out education in the last 3 to 4 to 5 years for want of whatever economic issue or for personal or background family issues, can they be incorporated in the implementation of this for the purpose of giving them the credit, that ABC system credit which we discussed today, can it be implemented for them also?
Yeah. Should I say something?
Please.
Yeah, so this scheme, number one, this question is very good. I think this point probably didn't occur to people like us who are involved in shaping it up, and this will be a valuable input for us that how we can cover these conditions also. So as of now, the scheme says that once the scheme is pronounced, every situation would be covered. And the life of a credit or life of a marks earned, whatever equivalent credit would be, may be typically minimum 5 to 6 years, maximum maybe 10, 12 years. It cannot be lifelong, of course, because the technologies and things change. But what we'll try to do is to facilitate the people who have suffered already, but who have no answer right now, they can be given a leeway, and we'll certainly think about it, put some conditions and make sure that their efforts don't go in vain. They are put to some sort of use, and that is what we will try to do. As of now, the scheme has not come out, but hopefully this scheme will be finalized. We have already given regulations for that to UGC, and hopefully the scheme will be finalized by December. And once again, it will be implemented next year onwards. That is our expectation.
Dr. Sunil, you wanted to comment?
Yes. Because for this kind of suggestion is very important and critical for university like RGPB. Even before coming of this NEP 2020, we were thinking of awarding some sort of diploma by giving some certain modularity in the whole teaching learning process. So definitely, in my personal opinion, these kind of students should be given opportunity in this new education policy.
Sir, valuable input. Another point which comes out is every time when we talk of higher education, it is related with employment. Like sir also did rightly mention that the parents only ask, or the student himself ask about employment. Why over a period of last so many years, and even now today also, why education is not focused towards positive thinking and making the student a better human being rather than only talking of employment?
It's a tough question. But you probably know that it is much bigger question than education alone. The opportunities available and the number of people vying for that is the biggest challenge in India. And that's why it becomes the four. It becomes the prime thing which is there. But it's all going to change because now is the age of knowledge or information or whatever, wisdom, whatever you call. And therefore, you will not survive with what you acquired in the first instance as degree. 25 to 65 or 70, 75 also you will study. And therefore, there'll be many adult learners or matured learners, as we call it. And therefore, education will be delivering many, many valuable things to oneself throughout the life. It is not going to be once in the life, which used to be the trend right now. The overall change which has happened, so education will also change, its delivery will also change, and its importance will also change.
Here I have some observation, Colonel. You see the biodata of all the performing artists, like actors, persons who are sports persons, who are musicians, who are photographers, who are all those musicians, you will find that they have not gone through this higher education system. Most of them have not gone through the higher education. It means that the higher education system is not performing as per their own expectations, or it is failing to fulfill their dreams. So under new education policy, which is more oriented towards students, and it's more is proposing solutions wherein there will be no distinction between curricular or extracurricular activities, it may be responding to the challenges which have been imposed by the society, and it means we can increase this gross enrollment ratio and bringing these kind of student also in the higher education system.
Very good, Sunilji. Your style of working, I've seen, I was moving with you in your university, and in between you entered into a room where students were performing some dance, something. And one of them was very good, extremely good. Immediately, you have taken out your purse and you have given some 500 rupees, not 5,000, 500 rupees you have given. Just that sort of motivation. So every level of the efforts which you are doing, basically for creating this university as a temple of learning and temple of motivation, it's something very great. Everyone should learn from you, the way you are functioning. These type of academic leaders are needed. So whatever the new education policy we are having in front of us, it will be implemented only if leaders like you, leaders like Professor Sancheti, and people who are sitting very serious, Professor Rakesh Sharma ji, Bansal ji, these type of leaders when we'll be having, then certainly it will be very easy to implement this policy. It will become, again, India will become hub of this knowledge. There is no doubt about this one. Only one issue, Rakesh ji, again I'll be responding. You said the demographic dividend, the advantage which we are having, young population, roughly 50% less than 25 years. I'm having certain worry also. They are just like human beings. If they are not getting converted into some useful human resource who can contribute for the betterment of the society, it can be means reverse also. Yes, it is just like a bomb. Yes, it can in reverse direction also it can work. So sole responsibilities which we people will have to do something very special for this young generation, which will be dream of this country, will be bring laurels for this whole country. Some one, two more questions we can take, yes, and then we'll be closing.
Sir, bulk of them, as I already said, sir, happen to be only the appreciations to the policy and the conduct of today's forum. But a very relevant point which I noted down in the chat box which has come is role of teachers vis-a-vis technology. How much to each one of them and where to draw a balance?
Teacher would not be a teacher alone. Teacher would be a facilitator. Teacher would be a mentor. Teacher would be a counselor. Teacher would be a friend. But teacher would be a co-learner. Only thing is, with his experience and maturity, he'll facilitate things much better compared to your own self doing it. And therefore, he'll be a co-learner. Teacher in Indian context was mostly a teacher, means teach, but now means he was only delivering the knowledge, or as we call assimilation, generation, and dissemination. So he was doing only dissemination. Now he'll be doing generation. So the teacher is going to be changing its role multifold. I would possibly say that teaching component itself for me would go down if it was teaching and learning was 50-50 amongst the students and teacher. I would say teaching will become 30% and learning or self-learning will become 70%. And therefore, teacher's role is going to substantially change. And when you have to do multiple tasks and maybe multiplexing and various other things of multi-nature, technology automatically comes in. And therefore, technology will be an integral part of our life. Forget about what I am going to say. It is already predicted by 2025, each one of us will have at least 5 to 6 or maybe 7 devices or sensors on us, IoT devices, which will be measuring, which will be doing something. So we'll be all technology enabled, technology driven, supported. I'm telling you the examinations, we say sitting in examinations, I will say I'll be doing standing examination. People ask, have you written your examination? I'll say, I have not written. I have spoken in my examination, gone in and spoken in the examination. Some people say, where is your computer? Computer, I'll be wearing in my body, which will be there. Some people ask me, where is your bag? I will say, this bag is my foldable LCD. There is a book in this, there is a copy in this, there is a pen in this, there is an examination paper in this, there is a library in this. I'll simply carry one drum or one cylinder, which is a foldable LCD display, and which will be my book. So technology will be integral to a teacher and to a student in every sense. This is my expectation. I'm sorry if I've gone overboard in explaining it. Thank you.
Sir, I have one point to say or add on. Okay. For a teacher, the technology may be great teaching assistant for you. Generally, teachers complain that there is no teaching assistance is available. But for a good teacher, this technology can be a great teaching assistant.
मैं just teacher की बात थोड़ी सी आपको कहूँगा. शिक्षक पढ़ाता है, आचार्य सिखाता है, गुरु रास्ता दिखाता है, सदगुरु उन रास्तों पे कैसे चला जाता है वो सिखाता है. तो सदगुरु की भूमिका में शिक्षक है. इसलिए ये बच्चे बार बार पूछ रहे हैं टेक्नोलॉजी का कितना यूज करोगे, कैंपस में कब बुलाओगे. देखो हमारा कितना बड़ा अट्रैक्शन है. अपन तो सोचते थे ना बच्चों को डांटते हैं, फटकारते हैं, आएंगे नहीं हमारे पास. कितना बड़ा धन धान्य हमारे पास है, कितने बड़े एसेट्स हैं. बच्चे आंखों में आंसू आ रहे, कहीं मेल आती है हमारे कि हमें क्यों सजा दे रही हो सर ये ऑनलाइन. हमारा इसमें क्या कसूर है कि ऑनलाइन क्या आप कह रहे हो जी आर बढ़ाओगे तो हम तो जी आर का पार्ट ही है. ऑनलाइन से बढ़ाओ, बाकी का बढ़ाओ, हमें तो कैंपस में बुलाओ. हमको जो है ऑनलाइन की सजा क्यों दे रहे हो. देखो ये हमारे लिए एक बहुत बड़ा कॉम्प्लीमेंट है. तो हमें जो है एक सदगुरु की जो भूमिका निभानी है कि उनको उस रास्ते पे कैसे चलना है और रास्ते पे क्या क्या दिक्कतें आएंगी उसका समाधान उनको कैसे निकालना है. एंड अब करीब करीब जो है अपन फैग एंड पे हैं, क्लोज कर रहे हैं. आदरणीय मेंबर सेक्रेटरी जी, राजीव जी हमारे साथ में है. राजीव जी आप कंक्लूड करिए, सबको धन्यवाद दीजिए और लगातार धन्यवाद देते रहिए. अपन चाय पानी नाश्ता कुछ भी अपन ने एक्सपर्ट्स के लिए नहीं किया है, पर जब भी चेयरमैन साहब कहते हैं कि जब भी यहाँ पे AICT में आओगे आप लोग, जब ये सिचुएशन ठीक हो जाएगी तब हम बिल्कुल बढ़िया भाव से जो है अच्छा चाय पानी जो है लंच का टाइम होगा तो अच्छी
व्यवस्था. पुनिया जी यहाँ किसी ने लिखा है कि करीब करीब अगले 2 साल तक शायद ये कोविड का क्राइसिस खत्म नहीं होने वाला है, तो तब तक हमको किसी को चाय पानी देना नहीं पड़ेगा इसका. लेकिन ऐसा नहीं चाहिए, जल्दी से जल्दी कोविड खत्म हो, हम जल्दी से जल्दी आपको चाय यहाँ बुला के चाय देंगे, कॉफी देंगे, खाना खिलाएंगे. सारे एक्सपर्ट को धन्यवाद.
थैंक यू वेरी मच टू ऑल पैनलिस्ट. So before I extend my formal thanks to all the experts and panelists, so I will try to summarize the discussion, although it was a lengthy discussion. So I will try my best to summarize it. The panel was started, the debate was started by Honorable Vice Chairman Professor M.P. Punia. He gave an overview of the national education policy and earlier discussion held on this 5 discussions we have already completed. So he gave an overview of all these discussions, and he also discussed the status of the GER and EER, and also suggested that there should be a connect between school education and the higher education, along with many more important things. Now, because today's discussion is on access, equity, quality, affordability, and accountability, because all these words, they are closely related to, we cannot define single word as a sole and independently we cannot define these words. So to my knowledge, what I can understand that all these words, they are very closely related. Then Professor Sancheti added three more dimensions on all these five words: accept, access, equality, quality, affordability, and accountability. He also talked about speed, efficiency, and diversity. And he also said he was also of the view that teaching as per expertise of the teachers should be emphasized rather than imposing the subjects and topics on the teachers. And he, as usual, he was giving more emphasis on the use of the technology in teaching and learning. And he also told the panelists about the initiative taken by him in various universities and institutions. One of them was FIIP, Faculty Industry Immersion Program, and another one was the ABC, along with our Honorable Vice Chairman, that is Academic Bank Credit. And he also emphasized that teachers having orientation toward research should be given freedom, more freedom, and teachers having orientation towards teaching should be given freedom, and they should not be, research should not be forced on them. So these were the suggestions, major suggestions given by Professor Sancheti. And Dr. Rakesh Sharma shared his view on equity and his experience in various government organizations dealing with this equity and other issues. And he also said that we should have the bridge courses as far as language and the other skills are required. So I would like to inform that AICT started an induction program in which some bridge courses on mathematics and communication skills, they were part of the 3 weeks induction program. And we are also making effort to provide material. This is literature in the regional languages also. And AICT is making all efforts to convert these SWAM courses in regional languages. So we are working on that. And hopefully in time to come, we will be able to provide these courses in regional languages. Professor Bansal, V.M. Bansal, he was of the view that the regulatory bodies, they should act as a facilitator. And he also shared his experience in running a prestigious institution in Delhi. So I hope that his experience and his advice will be of great use in framing and submitting this document to the MHRD. Professor Sunil Gupta, he was of the view, he was of the critical view that the equity not only among the students, equity must be there among the institutions also. So if I'm wrong, I think Professor Sunil will correct me. So this equity, he was also of the view that equity must be provided and quality must be attained. So he was of this view also. And he also said that the accountability of the teachers should be there. And I am also of that view that this whole education system is pure teachers ke charo taraf ghumta hai. Teachers duri hai education system ki. So, but they can make a lot of change. What we are all talking today's in discussion and earlier days discussion, teachers will definitely play an important role. But there is a good news for our teaching community also that during this pandemic, all our teaching community, without any formal training, they shifted to the technology. So we are talking about the technology. So this is a commendable task, and our teachers deserve great appreciation for this change without a formal training. And at the last, our chairman gave emphasis on online education, answered some of the concerns of the panelists as well as the those who are participating or listening this program. And he was giving more emphasis on the sharing of the resources. So with all this, this today's discussion was a great discussion. We will finalize this all. We have, our team is preparing the report on this discussion. We will share that report with you. We will incorporate your comments. If something is left in that report, we will incorporate them. And then we will submit all these reports to the MHRD. So in last, I will thank my panelists, all the participants, those who are attending this program through webinar or through YouTube, sharing, they have shared their views and as well as they have asked some questions which we were probably able to reply them. And I will also like to thank the vice chairman for moderating this program and giving a direction to the program, how we can proceed, and also giving valuable suggestions in between. And in last, our team headed by Kandal Venkat, his whole team from the faculty development cell, inviting pupil and also making arrangement for this webinar and compiling report. And in within half an hour or within an hour, they will compile the report. And probably by evening, during dinner time, you will get that report also. So we have a very efficient officer and a team headed by Kandal Bansal. Thank you, Dr. Kandal Bansal, for your commendable job. So in last, thanks to each and everyone. Thank you very much.
Just one point I think we have forgotten about this common entrance test for all the universities in the country. And the issue of equity, which has been raised by Sunil, I think some solution will be coming through that one. Playing field will be same for every student. So through common entrance tests, I think when students will be entered into various universities of the country, I think some concrete solution will be provided by that test.